Illinois gets set to take on the Gators of the University of Florida. And when you think about the Southeastern Conference and the Big Ten Conference, Lee, you think of tradition, you think of history, and you think of all the great players and coaches that have come through. You coached in the Big Ten. Let's talk about the differences in the conference's style of play.
Well, the Big Ten is more power, as SEC is speed. Illinois has got something to prove tonight. In 11 bowl games between the Big Ten and the SEC has won 8 games. Illinois needs to win this one, not only for themselves, but for the Big Ten.
Florida's been plagued by injuries. They lose all Southeastern Conference performer Trace Armstrong. He's out with a knee injury. That's bad news for Florida, but good news for Jeff George in Illinois.
The Illinois quarterback was all world when he came out of Indianapolis High School. He went to Purdue. He played well as a freshman. He's redshirted. He's matured. With John Makovic as his coach, there's a lot of people think that he could be a Heisman Trophy candidate in the next couple of years.
Meanwhile, the quarterback situation for Florida has been dismal all season. Lee, just 7 touchdowns in their last 7 games.
And also an interesting statistic, the quarterbacks from Florida have not thrown a touchdown pass against a Division 1A team the entire season. They've got to do a lot better than that.
We mentioned Jeff George, an outstanding sophomore. How about sophomore Emmett Smith? He was being touted as a Heisman Trophy candidate when this year began.
He's a great running back, but he needs some help. But if Smith can get 100 yards, remember, every game he's run 100 yards in this year, 6 of them, Florida's won. So they need Smith, but they need some help from the rest of the football team, too.
Emmett Smith is healthy, and he is raring to go tonight. Legion Field just reeks with history and nostalgia, and Chris Fowler has more on that. Chris?
You're right, Roger. This is one of the great football stadiums in America. So many great games over the years have been played here. Allegiant Field has a special meaning for a couple of Florida players. Trace Armstrong, he won't be in the game tonight, but he did grow up in Birmingham and played here as a peewee football player at age 10. There you see him, obviously disappointed about not playing tonight. Trace was a fullback in peewee football, weighing a slightly less than his 270 pounds. And of course, Emmett Smith got his first start in college football here last year against Alabama and broke the Florida single game rushing record with 224 yards. That's the game when he really exploded on the scene in college football. But this stadium will always belong to Bear Bryant. Some people say his ghosts still roam around this old stadium, Roger.
Chris, there have been many great matchups here at Legion Field between Alabama and Auburn, and tonight it's just the second ever meeting between the University of Florida and the University of Illinois. And you think about all the times major college football teams play against one another, this always has a little special meaning when they meet for just the second time as the University of Illinois, the Fighting Illini, take the field. 6-4-1 on the season, 5-2-1 in the Big Ten. And now the Gators of the University of Florida. They got off to that 5-0 start, finished at 6-5, and 4-3 in the Southeastern Conference. ESPN's presentation of the 1988 All-American Bowl, Illinois versus Florida, is being brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. By Transamerica for insurance and financial services. The power of the pyramid is working for you. And by the number one ski boot in the world. So many times this year. And Florida will receive the opening kickoff. Doug Higgins to kick it off for Illinois. Tony Lomac and Alonzo Sullivan back deep for Florida. As we're set to go, first of 3 big bowl games this weekend for you on ESPN. Second meeting, as I mentioned, Florida won 14-0 in Gainesville. Short kick taken at the 15-yard line. That's Kerry Watkins. Watkins to the 44-yard line. Patrick Donnelly made the tackles. Kyle Morris will quarterback Florida. Cedric Smith, Emmett Smith are the running backs. The wide receivers, Terrence Barber and Tony Lomac. The tight end, Mark McGriff. Up front, Tracy Daniels is the center. Kevin Sills and Chris Brownlee, the guards. David Williams and John Durden, the tackles for the Gators of the University of Florida. They've got great field positions. First and 10 from the 45-yard line. Man in motion is McGriff to the far side. Pitch back, Emmett Smith. Emmett Smith could go all the way. Touchdown, Florida. Play of the game, and the Gators have taken the lead.
A good play there by Smith. An awful nice call by the sideline. They put a man in motion, and watch Smith. It's a quick toss play. The thing that explodes right here, you see a good block by McGriff, number 80, the tight end, and then there he takes off. He outruns number 7, Cobb, and he's all the way for a touchdown. Remember, speed and quickness for the SEC against the Big Ten.
John David Francis, the point after, and it's good. Francis, 27 of 28 now on the year. And an unusual situation for Florida. They've got the lead.
Now they get the ball to Smith, number 22. 61, Sills gets a good block. Number 80, McGriff gets a good block. And now right here, you see the speed and quickness of Emma Smith. He outruns Cobb, number 7, and he outruns number 33, Chris Green, to the end zone.
His 10th rushing touchdown of the year.
It's a simple toss play. What they did is they overloaded and put one extra man, the man in motion, to the short field, and they outnumbered the Illinois defense, and that's why Smith got in there with that kind of a play.
He rushed this year for 988 yards. He missed two games and half another, and you see Jerry Anderson, one of the assistants for the University of Florida, and Galen Hall there stepping into the picture. And Galen, he hasn't had a lot to smile about at the end of this year, but he's got to feel good because his team has always had great defensive work. They've been a tremendous defensive team. Now the offense has given the defense something to work with.
Well, you know, you talked about it at the top of the show. Smith likes this field. He likes this stadium. He got 224 yards the last time. I've always believed that psychologically backs play better in places they feel comfortable.
Francis kicks it off. And Keith Jones will take it at the 6. Jones to the 25-yard line. As we'll check out Illinois and Jeff George, their quarterback. In the backfield, Keith Jones and Mike Griffin. The wide receiver, Stephen Williams and Mike Bellamy. The tight end is Doug Amaya. The center, Kurt Lovelace. The guards, Tim Simpson and Joe Scabese. And Craig Schneider and Mark McGowan, the tackles for the Fighting Illini. And there's a look at 6'4", 213-pound sophomore Jeff George, who spent his freshman year at Purdue. First and 10 from the 25-yard line. They'll go right back to Jones. And he's to the 26 and doesn't get much. Rondy Weston there to make the stop as we check out the Gators. Brad Culpepper getting the start tonight at nose guard. That's because of the injury to Trace Armstrong, because Jeff Roth, the nose guard, moves to defensive tackle along with Rondy Weston. The backers on the inside, Pat Moore and Joey Nicoletto. Owen Bartrup and Huey Richardson on the outside. The corners, Richard Fain and Kerry Watkins. The safeties, Bill Lang and the great one, Lewis Oliver. Second and 9. George with plenty of time, and he's got Steve Williams at the 37-yard line, where he's met by Lewis Oliver, 12 yards on the pickup.
It's important for a quarterback like George to start off with some success. That time he went down to his favorite receiver, Williams, who's from Los Angeles, California, used his speed to find an open spot. George delivered it straight. Completion early in the game is good for a quarterback.
Jeff George and the Illinois offense, they really spread it around in their passing game. 6 different receivers with at least 20 receptions on the year. First and 10 from the 38. Williams comes in motion now. George going deep to Williams. And no, he's out of bounds. he made the catch at the 35-yard line. Lewis Oliver was the man over there on the coverage.
In college football, you must get at least 1 foot in. That ball was just a little bit to the outside. I would not be surprised if George and Makovic didn't come back to that play to Williams, because he was wide open. The ball was just thrown a little bit too far to the right.
Williams comes out of the game. Also, tight end Dan Donovan comes out right now on second and 10. And look at this tight formation lead.
They use this to spread and shift to try to confuse a defensive team.
And that's what they've done. Both wide receivers to the top of your screen. And they hand it off to Jones. Jones gets little or nothing. A penalty marker down at the 35-yard line. Keith Jones is a 6'1", 207-pound senior from Rock Hill, Missouri. And motion is the call against Illinois. You know, Jones, not only their leading rusher with over 1,000 yards, but also their leading receiver this year.
He caught 13 passes in the Michigan State game for 119 yards, and that's in one game. That is something.
Illegal procedure, 6 men on the line against the offense. Penalty declined. It'll be third down.
In some schools, that's almost like a career.
He really caught the attention, this man, Jeff George. The third game of the year, they'd lost to Washington State, they had lost to Arizona State, and they had Utah, which is a prolific passing team, and George really came to the forefront in that game, and then he just went on from there to have a tremendous season. Third and 8 now from the 40 as they go into the shotgun. Midfield at the 49-yard line. Kerry Watkins there on the coverage.
Mike Bellamy is from Chicago, Illinois, number 2. He has the fastest indoor time in the United States in 1987. Watch him drive the man deep and come back. But the thing I like about that, watch the concentration. Watch his concentration. Did you notice the eyes right on the football with his hands? Watch it. That is an excellent catch and a tremendous play.
Watkins was really playing off of him, Lee.
Well, that's why, because he ran the fastest indoor time, 6.1 in a 60-yard dash in 1987.
That's Jets. That's having some Jets behind him. First and 10. Call it the 48-yard line. Williams is in motion. And penalty markers down. Too much time taken by Illinois. So after that beautiful catch by Bellamy, they take too much time to get the next playoff.
Dead ball, delay of game, just the offense, still first down.
What about the transition for John Makovic coming in from the professional ranks to the college ranks again? He'd been at Wake Forest earlier, but it'd been a long time, Lee.
Yeah, but he told us yesterday at our meeting he'd like very much being back with the college football player. He doesn't have to worry about the agents. He doesn't have to be worried about one owner. All he has to do is worry about winning and doing a good job as an athletic director also.
First and 15. Jones with a spin move back across midfield to the original line of scrimmage. Let's check out the defense right now for the Florida Gators. As you take a look, fourth in the nation this year. And Lee, for a long time, they were second in the nation. That final game against Florida State when the Noles erupted for 52 points, knocked them down a notch or two.
Coach Gary Darnell, the defensive coordinator, came from Wake Forest and did a very nice job with the Florida defense.
Second and 10 now. Both wide receivers split to the near side. Penalty markers down. This is a freebie. As Jones cracks it to the 42-yard line. Joey Nicoletto was in on the tackle, but it's going to be offsides against the University of Florida. Take a look at Jones. Caught 46 passes for 374 yards. Rushed for over 1,100 yards. You see his ranking. And John Makovic mentioned an interesting thing to us about Jones yesterday. Makovic said, you know, he was a great kickoff returner.
Offside, defense, replay second down.
He was a great kickoff returner a year ago, as a matter of fact, ranked fifth in the nation, first in the Big Ten. He felt it was going to be too much for him this year, but he said, we were doing a terrible job on kickoff returns, so he put him back on about midseason. Second and 5 now after a couple of penalties against each team. Just over 11 minutes to go. George going deep to Bellamy. just off his hands at the 5-yard line. Kerry Watkins, a junior from Pensacola, was back in the coverage. George has got an interesting release.
He throws it three-quarter sidearm, and I had a quarterback named Babe Loffenberg who went on to play for San Diego Chargers that did the same thing. And the only thing I asked Babe to do was try to throw the ball so that we could catch him. I didn't care if he threw it underhanded or sidearm. The same thing with George. What you want to be careful, Roger, is not to change a young man at this point in his career.
Third and five. At the 43-yard line, out of the shotgun. Inside handoff, and Florida smelled it out perfectly. Right there was Pat Moore, the junior from Pensacola, the leading tackler for the Florida Gators. And that'll bring up a punting situation. That's Brian Menkhausen, a junior from Hazelwood, Missouri. 66 punts, 36 and a half yards. Punting has been a problem for both teams this year, as Menkhausen will kick it from his 40. Low line drive kick. And Terrence Barber at the 12-yard line downs it as Romero Bryce was there on the coverage. There's a flag down. And the flag's going to be against Illinois.
They'll probably make Illinois kick the ball because Illinois has had four punts blocked this year. So they might even try to go after another one.
Well, the story on Menkhausen, he is a tight end. And Illinois didn't have a punter when Makovic got there because the previous coach, Mike White, didn't believe in giving scholarships to the punters, place kickers, that sort of thing.
On the offense, the replay fourth down.
So Makovic put an ad in the student paper. He begged people to come out and could kick the ball. Finally, Menkhausen got the job, and he's done a pretty good, well, he's not done a great job, but he's done as good as he can do. Let's put it that way.
Let's put it this way. He's the best they got, and that's better than having somebody else out there.
Now from his 35-yard line. Oh, he got a good one off that time. And Barber at the 10. So they gained a couple of yards, 40 yards on the punt by Menkhausen. ESPN's presentation of the 1988 All-American Bowl, Illinois versus Florida, is being brought to you by the German Florida Gators will now run their second offensive play of the night. Emmett Smith took the opening handoff, 55 yards. They've got it first and 10 from their 11. In motion to the near side is Tony Lomac. And they go to Emmett Smith again, and this time he gets about 50 yards less, but look at the way he battles and pounds ahead. Smith is not known for his great speed, but he showed you on that first touchdown. Mo Gardner's the nose guard for Illinois. Mel Agee and John Wachter are the defensive tackles. Derek Brownlow, he's a great one. Steve Glasson, the inside backers. Greg Conrad and Romero Bryce on the outside. The corners, Henry Jones and Chris Green. And the safeties for Illinois, Glenn Cobb and Marlon Primus, an outstanding freshman from Carson, California. Second and five. McGriff in motion. Emmett Smith again. And Smith near the 20. Steve Glasson, the inside backer, a junior from Palos Park, Illinois, came up to make the stop.
One thing that's obvious already, the offensive line of Williams, Sills, Daniels, Bromley, and Durden of Florida are pushing the Illinois defenders back. That's 8 yards or 9 yards in two running plays. That shows that the Florida is controlling the offensive line of scrimmage.
AG and Gardner have been hurt this year. Third down and one. Smith. He's got the first down to the 24-yard line. Glenn Cobb, a senior from Pasadena, California, a junior college transfer from a year ago, comes up to make the stop as Smith will go over to the sideline and take a breath. And they're not losing much when they bring in Willie McClendon to take his place.
McClendon was the player of the year in Florida last year from Jacksonville. He's an outstanding player.
First and 10 now for the Gators from the 23. The
McClendon is number five. He's in the slot to the far side. They give it to the fullback, Cedric Smith, and he goes nowhere. He is stopped right at the line of scrimmage. One of the players in the stop, that's Sean Turner.
They go to the fullback this time, number 39, Cedric Smith, and 65, Turner came on a blitz, which means he starts on the outside and comes pinching down the line. He beat the Florida offensive line to the point of attack.
Turner and Conrad will alternate at that outside backer position, second and 10. Morris throws for the first time, and he's got his receiver. That's Terrence Barber, as Barber runs out of bounds at the 32-yard line. Chris Green on the coverage, and that's going to be just shy of a first down.
That was the best pass we've seen Morris throw in the three games we've done, the Florida games. He came back, threw the ball beautifully off the back foot. Now watch him. He gets good pass protection, but this is the secret. Now watch him plant his back foot and throw the ball off his front foot. A lot of quarterbacks will throw off that back foot and not get the zip on him. Excellent play by Kyle Morris, number one.
Third down and one. Emmett Smith. First down, Gators across the 35 to the 36. Derek Brownlow, the sophomore from Indianapolis, 155 tackles on the year. He's only 5'11", 229 pounds.
Number 61, Kevin Sills. Number 73, David Williams. Number 52, they're all coming off the ball and really controlling the line of scrimmage. As Emmett Smith gets the ISO play. A tremendous shoulder block by 39, Cedric Smith. Clear the linebacker out, first down. Florida.
From the 37-yard line, Emmett Smith trying to get outside, and he can't do it. Smith tried to get to the outside. Mo Gardner, the nose tackle, a sophomore from Indianapolis, and Mel Agee, who Luke Tepper, the defensive coordinator, tells us, and he coached Bruce Smith at Virginia Tech, tells us that Agee could be better than Smith by the time he's a senior.
You think he's an athlete? He averaged 18 points and 20 rebounds while he was a high school basketball player in Chicago, Illinois, in the best league in the city.
Second and seven, 6:32 left to go. First quarter, Florida leads it 7-0. Morris has got Smith at the 44-yard line. Derek Brownlow, 48. Folks, if you've watched NFL football and you've seen Sam Mills of New Orleans, they say Brownlow is a clone of him.
Number 22, Emmett Smith, is coming out of the backfield. A little ISO play. The one good thing about that is you notice that Lynn Amedee, the offensive coordinator, is trying to get the ball into Emmett Smith's hands all kinds of ways, throwing and running.
Third down and three. Griff inside the 40 to the 37-yard line. Henry Jones makes a stop on a beautiful play action. And they find the tight end McGriff with just his 21st catch of the year.
Nice little fake to number five, McClendon. But watch Morris again. Notice how he's throwing the ball off his back foot where he gets him zipped. Number 20, McGriff, whose dad was a great player at Florida, came across wide open because the play action fake throws the linebackers to the inside.
19 yards on the reception. And for Florida, first and 10 from the 36-yard line. McClendon still on his feet, just battles his way to the 33. Derek Brownlow and Steve Glasson, the inside backers, combine on a tackle.
Derek Brownlow is from Indianapolis, Indiana, number 48, 5'11", 229 pounds. And on the replay, you'll watch him come from the inside. Now watch him. He's reading the line. He's coming. He's scraping in good position. Now he takes on one of the blockers, number 61, Sills, and makes the tackle partially. But the reason why he didn't make the great play is because 61, Sills got into his body.
A Butkus finalist, the youngest Butkus finalist, the only sophomore of those Elite 12. As Barber comes in motion to the near side on second and seven, and here comes McClendon, and he is stuck behind the line of of scrimmage. Mo Gardner, the speedy nose tackle, the sophomore from Indianapolis, another Indianapolis player. There are eight of them on this University of Illinois football team.
Mo Gardner is, as you said, 6'2", 258, a sophomore. Watch him pursue inside out. They think he could be the best lineman in the Big Ten within the next 2 years. The reason why he's such a great lineman, he's got tremendous feet. He can jump over those blockers and get to the outside.
A.G. Gardner and Walker, all sophomores, the front three for Illinois. Third and seven for the Gators. And on the far side, the pass was intended for Tony Lomax. Henry Jones had the coverage, and that'll bring up a fourth down for the University of Florida. And John David Francis, the place kicker for the Gators, will come on the field. Francis, on the year, 17 of 24. This will be a 51-yard attempt. And he is 0 for 4 from 50-plus. High snap. Not enough on it. And that kick comes up short. He had it between the uprights, but it came up short. 3:40 to go. And Florida has... Lee Corso, Chris Fowler along with you at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Galen Hall, the head coach for the Gators, as Jeff George and the Fighting Illini will take it first and 10 from the 34-yard line as both wide receivers, Bellamy and Williams, split to the far side. Keith Jones to the 44-yard line where Kerry Watkins comes up from his cornerback position to make the tackle.
Illinois gets in a T formation and they shift out trying to confuse the defensive secondary. Good play by Jones. He gets the ball deep enough. He makes a good break. Number 45, Moore comes from the outside. But one of the things I like about that strategy, it doesn't allow the Florida defense to dig in there because it confuses them to the last minute.
Just the fourth 1,000-yard rusher in Illinois history. Grabowski, J.C. Caroline, a couple of the other names. Handoff up the middle to Howard Griffith, the fullback, who rushed for over 600 yards this year. Pat Moore is there to meet him. Griffith, a sophomore from Chicago, goes 5'11 and 214 as Illinois got the first down on that carry.
Griffith had an outstanding high school career. He averaged over 50 yards per kickoff return during his high school career. Can you imagine kicking to him the third time? He must have got rid of that coach and kicked it to him the third time.
You think he figured out by that?
Yeah.
I thought you guys were smarter than that.
I hope so.
First and 10 from the 47-yard line. Jones, penalty markers down. Some movement up front for the University of Florida. Bill Lang came up from a strong safety position to make the tackle. Let's go down to Chris Fowler. Chris?
Okay, Roger. The Illinois defense has recovered. They were a little shaken by the early touchdown run by Emmett Smith. And listen into their huddle. Interesting. The leadership on that defense is coming from young guys. It's Derek Brownlaw, the sophomore, jumping up and down, yelling in his guy's face. And, of course, Marlon Primus, the freshman safety, is also providing inspiration. It's a young team, and young guys are the leaders, Roger.
Thanks, Chris. You know, in our meeting with John Makovic yesterday, John said he's never seen two better plays in pressure situation by anybody on any level than Marlon Primus had against Northwestern in that game that got him here to the All-American Bowl. First down and 5, 5-yard penalty against Florida for being offsides. George, quick drop, comes to the near side as tight end Doug Amaya, the sophomore from Oak Park, Illinois, was tackled by Pat Moore, and Moore is everywhere for the University of Florida. Also, Ephesians Bartley was also there, as that's another first down for the Illini. That's the Chris Fowler's fan club down the sidelines. You didn't know that, did you?
I didn't think so. I do now.
Jeff George, 3 of 5 for 30 yards. First and 10 now at the 41. Try to screen it. It's not there. George is in trouble. Throws it between three men and completes it. And who was it? Keith Jones. was his leading receiver. What a great job of scrambling by Jeff George. And Lee, as we watched in the films, he didn't try to throw it back across the field. He threw it where he was supposed to.
Absolutely. Good call, Roger, because what he does this time, he's rolling out to the right. They have a blitz on him, but he squares his shoulders right there and throws it straight. Most quarterbacks make a mistake of throwing the ball back to the middle of the field where all the opponents are. Excellent play by Jeff George.
And he got it between three men as Keith Jones, the most receptions ever by an Illinois running back, and that'll get the attention of the NFL scouts. Second and three from the 34-yard line. George slipped, but he regained his balance. Penalty marker now down. And there's another penalty marker is going to be thrown. The intended receiver was Dan Donovan. Watkins grabbed his jersey because Donovan had him beat. There's going to be a holding call and a pass interference call.
And what'll happen, they'll do redo the play. If there's two live ball penalties, you redo the play. If one of them's a dead ball penalty, then you do both penalties. This will be no play, do it over.
We have holding on the defense, holding on the offense. Penalty's all set. We'll replay second down.
That should be a song. Holding on the defense, holding on the offense. Reset, and it'll be another first down.
One of the reasons you get holding, right there on the left side of your picture, you'll see number 68, Snyder, got a hold of number 96, Roof, and what he does is he actually just pulls him down like a takedown. One of the things you teach the offensive lineman, if you're going to hold, do never hold a guy on the outside. Sneak up underneath him, grab him by the numbers.
That's good advice, all you young offensive linemen out there from Lee Corso. Second and three from the 34 as they replay the down. Now we'll screen it to the near side. Griffith, still on his feet. Griffith to the 26-yard line, and that'll be an Illinois first down. Lewis Oliver came over to really stick him on the near side, and Illinois wanted a penalty. They thought it was a late hit.
It was probably wanted a penalty because it was a hit that was too hard. Number 18, Lewis Oliver, is a man playing in the with a bunch of boys. Watch this shot right here. Wow, does he hit him.
Is that a good hit?
Oh, is that a good hit? He's 6'2", 222 pounds, all man from Belgrade, Florida.
You see Griffith is checking his chin out to see if it's still there. First and 10, though, for the Illini. 37 seconds to go, first quarter. George has got to scramble again. Boy, dangerous pass right there. The intended receiver was Doug Amaya. Kerry Watkins on the coverage as George has had to do a lot of scrambling here in this first quarter. Seconds left to go.
There's John Makovic. In his left hand, he had the checklist. John Makovic calls his plays for the Illinois offense.
Lou Holtz does the same for Notre Dame.
But Marty Schottenheimer used to for the Cleveland Browns.
Yeah, he used to. That's exactly
right. That's the difference between pro ball and college.
Second and 10 from the 25 as they give it to Jones. Keith Jones down to the 11-yard line and close to another first down. Stop once again, and they're looking over to the sideline. Do they want to call a timeout right now with 10 seconds to go? Is the wind a factor at all? Jones says, no, it's only the first quarter. We don't need a timeout. And that'll end the first quarter from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, with the Florida Gators behind the 55-yard touchdown run of Emmett Smith leading Illinois. We're back with you at Legion Field in Birmingham, the 12th All-American Bowl, and Florida with a 7-0 lead, but Lee, Illinois getting ready to punch it in. They're at the 16-yard line.
They like three tight ends in this situation. If they're in the I formation, you can watch for 36. If they shift from the I, keep your eye on number 29.
Third down and one. Didn't get it. Keith Jones didn't get it. Tim Hawk was the man that came up to make the stick.
They try to run to the left side. Number 69 gets a good block there, Simpson, but a tremendous play by Hawk, number 98. That went against their theory. Now it's fourth down. Let's see what they do. Usually on fourth and third down and short yardage, they like to go the right side of the number 64.
is checked into the game, number 39, on fourth and one. Amaya comes in motion, and they give it to Turner inside the 10. That's a first down as Pat Moore and Richard Fain made the tackle, but they did a little counter that time, and Turner, with only 12 carries coming into this game, gets the first down.
Number 39 makes a great play, but number 64 was the seeker. Secret on that play, Mark McGowan. That's where they should have gone the last time. He's the best blocker they've got. Watch him. He clears out the right side. And there's Turner running for a first down. Good call because they went to what they do best and forgot about playing against Florida.
Turner, a senior from Galesburg, Illinois, stays in the game on first and goal from the 8-yard line as George nearly has it picked off. Richard Fain was one of the men over there on the coverage, and also 29 Owen Bartra, who looked like he might have gotten a piece of the football. The intended receiver was Mike Bellamy.
They went to Bellamy, number two, because he's their clutch receiver down the goal line. In fact, he's the gentleman that caught the ball against Indiana in the left-hand corner to win that ball game.
Bellamy with just two touchdown catches on the year. As it's now second down and goal from the 8-yard line as Amaya comes in motion to the near side, and they hand it off inside. Jones had the end zone in front of him, and he stumbled and fell at the 2-yard line. Joey Nicoletto might have got a shoestring to trip him up.
Wasn't that a great call? They gave you the perception that it was going to be an outside play, but number 69, Tim Simpson from East Peoria, Illinois, pulls a trap. There's that number 64, Mark McGowan from Evergreen Park, Illinois, and they both blew the Florida men back into the end zone.
I said Nicoletto might have gotten a shoestring. Well, he was the man that was being blocked. It was the closest man to where Jones fell down. Third down and goal from the 2-yard line. Well, there was a hold in the end zone. I don't know if they got it or not. And it's intercepted. 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 28, Richard Fain with his fourth interception of the year. There's a penalty marker down. But Dan Donovan, the tight end, if we watch him, he was held early on.
Makes a good inside relief, Donovan. Now he's held right there by number 49, Nicoletto. I'm not so sure, Roger, they saw that. I'm not so sure they're not going to call a face mask.
That's what they
on
got.
Number 85, Donovan. But he was held. George made the critical mistake. When in doubt, throw the ball out of bounds. Never throw the ball into the end zone across your body.
George was looking at him all the way, and when he was held up for just that moment, George hesitated and then moved out a little further and tried to force it in there. And Fain with his fourth interception.
Well, face mask on the white team after the interception. It'll be first down, orange team.
So Illinois doesn't take advantage of a great scoring opportunity, and we'll be right back. The other Big Ten Southeastern Conference matchup on New Year's Day night.
Bootleg by Jeff George. He's trying to get the ball to Donovan, number 85. Fain, number 28 from North Fort Myers, Florida, is in good position. But George made, and there's the face mask by Donovan, number 85. The mistake that George made here is when he rolled out, he threw the ball back across his body where the opponents were. We made a point of that. He did a terrific job about 5 minutes ago of not doing that.
So Illinois with an excellent opportunity. The interception thrown by George, his ninth of the year. And now first and 10 for the Gators from the 25-yard line. And they go to Emmett Smith. And Smith goes to the 26, a gain of about one, as Mo Gardner is in on the tackle one more time. And also Glenn Cobb, the strong safety. Now, they made a change in their secondary, which was a big key for them, Lee, this year.
They moved Cobb, from free safety to strong safety, and they really helped themselves because they brought Primus in, number 16. That time, you noticed that Gardner had quick enough feet that he could get along the line of scrimmage and still catch Smith from the backside.
Emmett Smith, 7 carries, 75 yards. We're just underway, second quarter from the All-American Bowl in Birmingham. That pass was deflected, and it's picked off. Steve Glasson with his second interception of the year brings it back to the 30-yard line, but that pass was deflected at the line of scrimmage.
pass number one, runs a little bootleg action. He gets good pass protection, but there the man deflects it. Brownlow, number 48, must have been blitzing because that's not his area. So he blitzed, and number 41, Glasson, gets to the hole. Now watch it. You're right, Roger. He must have been in an outside blitz because he shouldn't have been in that area.
So an interception by Illinois, and they've got it first and 10 at the 30. Jones. Senior Keith Jones, his 11th rushing touchdown of the year. And isn't it ironic, after the turnover, the first play, Lee, how many times that happens?
You'll notice they have an unbalanced line, and this is what happened. They outnumbered Florida by shifting and caught them and outflanked them. That's why no one touched them, because they got Florida out of position by shifting, and Jones goes all the way.
Doug Higgins to attempt the point after. He's a perfect 27 of 27 this year, and make it 28 of 28. 12:05 to go first half. We're tied at 7. Of the 1988 All-American Bowl, Illinois versus Florida, is being brought to you by the new generation of Oldsmobile. Step into the future now at your Oldsmobile dealer. And by the U.S. Army. Learn how to get an edge on life. Be all you can be. Roger Twibel, Lee Corso, Chris Fowler with you at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Doug Higgins to kick it off, the Fighting lineup. We've got two tremendous touchdown runs by Emmett Smith and Jones for Illinois. Short kick this time. And Tony, make that Emmett Smith who's back there. 23 yards on the return, and a little scuffle there as Glenn Kahn came out to make the tackle.
On the replay, the touchdown. Notice there's three men on the left side of your screen. That was the unbalanced line. No one touches Jones. The reason why they don't touch him is that Illinois shifted and outflanked and outnumbered the Florida defense, and that's why he went all the way.
Interception, 30-yard touchdown run. Glasson the intercept, Jones the run, feigned the interception in the end zone, and a 55-yard touchdown run by Emmett Smith. First and 10 with the 34-yard line for the Gators of the University of Florida. And Emmett Smith is stuck behind the line of scrimmage. Mo Gardner on another tackle. 6'2", 254, a sophomore from Indianapolis, who came into this game with 68 tackles, and he's been on a half a dozen already tonight.
Illinois does a good job of recruiting at Indianapolis because it isn't very far to drive from Indianapolis to Champaign. And if the kid doesn't want to go to Indiana, Purdue, or Notre Dame, it's the closest school.
Second down and 14. Pitch back to Emmett Smith. Smith just ducks his head and gets to the 35. Let's go to Chris Fowler. Chris?
Okay, Roger, the big guy here is the former number one pick out of Auburn. Andre Bruce now plays with the Atlanta Falcons. Why don't all you old SEC guys stick together?
Well, mainly because we went to high school together. I played with them, I played against them, so it's like a family.
So you're rooting for Florida tonight. You love a good defensive game.
Oh, yes, definitely. I see Galen is letting his inside backers roam, and it's helping them a lot.
You said he only watches the linebackers in the football game, Roger. Back to you.
And why not? He's a great one. Third down and 10. Kyle Morris with all day. He goes to Emmett Smith on the near side. It's a bad pass. Had plenty of time to throw it. And Florida sputters.
If you notice, Morris goes back here. He wants to throw the ball to number 20, Lomax Smith. You see him? He's looking downfield, looking downfield. Now he has to go to his third receiver, and he doesn't open up his hips. By not opening up his hips, he has to throw across his body, and he always throws short when you do that.
Francis now will punt it from the 20. He's averaging just over 36 yards a kick. Hit a good one there. And the fair catch by Steven Williams at the 30-yard line. 36 yards, his season average. We're tied at 7. They're tied up at 7 apiece with 10:23 to go first half, and just a penalty after that punt. Unsportsmanlike conduct, Lee.
It was on Illinois, and it was a dead ball penalty, which means that Illinois has the ball, but it's first down and 25 for the Illini.
Good crowd here tonight at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama for this 12th All-American Bowl. 65,000 tickets were sold for the game, and beautiful day here. Temperature in the low 40s to high 30s, and this has been an outstanding football game so far. A couple of great offensive plays and a couple of great defensive plays.
They should be proud. The All-American Bowl and the Rose Bowl are the only two bowls that feature universities that both belong to the Association of American Universities, top 56 public and private institutions.
It's impressive. First and 25 from the 16-yard line for Jeff George and Illinois. As he goes to the far side, his intended receiver was Keith Jones, his outstanding running back and leading receiver, Jerry Odom, was over on the coverage. Lee, I almost think I'm watching an inter-squad scrimmage here with the white jerseys and orange pants of Illinois and the orange jerseys and white pants of Florida, both teams with orange helmets.
You asked the question, why didn't Illinois wear blue? The NCAA rule says that the visiting team must wear white, and that's why they had to wear white.
Jeff George has missed on his last four passes, second and 25. He's going down the middle, that's Sean Watts, and he's across the 40 and close to a first down at the 42-yard line. Is a string bean. He's 6'4", 170 pounds, a sophomore from Rockford, Illinois.
Number 64, Mark McGowan, Evergreen Park, Illinois. Good position. You notice how he got into position. He took one man on, then he took number 96, Jeff Ralph, out. That allows Wax to move to the inside behind Joey Nicoletto. What they do on that pattern is they go down behind the linebacker and they find an open spot and squat right there, and George hit him.
26 yards on the pickup, a first down for Illinois. Leaps over people to get to the 48-yard line where Joey Nicoletto, a senior from Tampa, makes the tackle. Keith Jones is the type of back who this year, Lee, not only became the most versatile back in the Big Ten, but really started to attract a lot of attention from pro scouts because of all the things he can do.
One of the things that pro scouts look for in a running back is what he does without the football. And he does a good job of blocking and also faking, and that's why he's so high on their list.
Second and five. That's Hartley, the tight end in motion. Inside, they give it to Jones again. And Jones is right at midfield. He's going to be a couple of yards shy of the first down. Jeff Roth, 96, makes a tackle. I want to ask you about Jeff Roth. He's been the nose guard all year for the University of Florida. Now he moves to the outside. What kind of adjustment is it for him?
It's a tough adjustment to play. In fact, it's a much tougher position to play on the nose than it is the tackle. But what they must have done is had enough time to practice them. I never liked to make two moves. When you move Roth outside, you make two moves. He moves from his original position and you move another man in. I would have rather seen Neely come in and play for Armstrong one move.
Third down, let's call it a long two, nearly 3 yards. Quick pitch to the outside. Griffith has got the first down at the 45-yard line. Nicoletto once again on the tackle, and now we're starting to see Illinois put some drives together and grind some things out.
Illinois is doing something right now that Florida has problems with. They're moving the ball around. They're throwing the ball in the flat. They're running a little screen. They're throwing the ball in the middle. They're running to the outside. And unless Galen Hall's defense does something, takes a calculated risk, which could blow the game wide open, Illinois is going to continue to move the ball.
7:53 to go, first half, first and 10, the 45-yard line of Florida. The blitz that time, George gets it away, nearly intercepted. Kerry Watkins had it right in his hands and couldn't hold on to it. But a lot of pressure that time, Lee, as you just mentioned. They needed to take a chance, and they did. Pat Moore was one of the players who was coming hard on that play.
The reason why we call it a time for a blitz is because they could see Galen Hall with his defensive coordinator, Gary Darnell, could see that they were getting outmatched. So therefore, you have to take a calculated risk. A very fine call from the press box.
6 of 13 now for 71 yards. It's 2nd and 10 from the 45. George in trouble again, and he's ducked. Jeff George with a lot of pressure, and getting to him back there was number 98, Godfrey Miles, and also Jeff Roth, 96. Miles is a sophomore from Carroll City in Miami.
Miles, number 98, played strong safety and free safety against the Florida State Seminoles, a game we had. Talk about a versatile athlete. He's up there rushing the passer right now. Notice he's got that little extra speed and quickness that could close the gap real quick on George.
It looked like Jeff George was faking a screen to the left and trying to come back to maybe a tight end screen on the right. It wasn't there, and they're faced with a 3rd and 22 now. George gets rid of it. It hit the hands of the intended receiver. That was Howard Griffith, but it was way short of being a first down as Miles was once again putting some pressure on. And that time, after you get to a quarterback once, then you start making him think about things a little more.
Interesting. Number 90, Richardson. The outside linebacker is also in there. Number 98, Miles, and 98, Richardson are not the biggest Florida linemen, but they're the quickest. Florida has made a move to the quick defensive linemen and not the big linemen now that Armstrong is out.
Menkhausen standing at his 28-yard line. Terrence Barber is back deep for Florida. That's a low line drive kick, and Barber takes it to 20, but he can't get outside as Illinois with good coverage. Matt Pater, a junior linebacker from Park Ridge, Illinois, was the first man down to hit him as we're tied at 7 in the All-American Bowl. They know when the camera comes on. Florida tied up at 7, 6:37, left to go in the first half, and the Gators have it 1st and 10 from the 23-yard line. Haven't really been able to do anything with it offensively since early in the first quarter. It's Kyle Morris. Hands it off right up the middle. That's Dexter McNabb, a freshman from Bethuniac Springs, 6'1 and 232 pounds, who gets just a couple as John Wachter, sophomore from Wheaton, Illinois. They list him at 248, but number 99 goes more like about 230.
Wachter's an interesting story. He started off as number 42 as a linebacker, moved to the number 80 as a tight end, and now he's number 99 as a defensive end.
2nd down and 7. McClendon to the 30. Oh, he had a couple of men out front pulling for him that time as he gets a gain of about 6 yards. Derek Brownlow and Glenn Cobb stopping 2 yards short of a first down.
Anytime you want to see if a defense is playing aggressive football, count the number of jerseys around the ball when the contact is made right here. You'll see number 41, Glasson. Then you'll see number 48, Brownlow. Number 9, Jordan. You count them. There's at least 6 to 7 white jerseys around the ball carrier.
3rd down and 3. Barber's in motion to the far side. Option by Morris. He's got nowhere to go. Sean Turner was the first man to get to him. Let's go to Chris Fowler. Chris.
Okay, fellas, one of the high-tech tools of recruiting these days is a battery telephone. This is Illinois' recruiting coordinator, Randy Rogers. He's had this phone with him all week. Tonight, he's made about 100 phone calls to recruits across the country, making sure they're watching the game on television. Let's listen in a little bit.
It's gorgeous. It's a little bit cool, but great night for football.
Okay, a weather report. Hey, Rogers, we could order a pizza from down here.
Do it, Chris. I mean, we've got halftime to fill. 4th and 5. High punt. High snap, excuse me, but Francis is able to get the punt off. Oh, man, Florida dodged a bullet right there. As as the ball will be down at the 48-yard line, 21 yards on the punt by John David Francis, and what a great athletic feat. Athletic feat, did you get that? to get that punt off.
Has step, but he's got presence right now to turn and just kick it any way he can. The presence of mind that he had, he didn't try to get the ball. Now watch, it's a high snap. He didn't try to get the football now and turn it around and get a spiral. He's taught, once it's a high snap, turn around and just kick it any way you can. Good play by France.
The best thing he didn't do is try to run with it. Oh. But Illinois has got excellent field position at the 46-yard line of Florida. First and 10 with 4:28 to go. First half, both wide receivers split to the near side. As Jones will take it, and Keith Jones pounds up the middle to the 40-yard line where Pat Moore makes the tackle. Jones can run inside, he can run outside, he can catch the football, he can return kickoffs.
And he can also throw the ball.
Yes.
He's throwing the ball completed 3 out of 5 passes for 2 touchdowns. So when they get near the scoring zone, watch out, he might throw the running pass.
Galen Hall, his team tied with Illinois at 7. Second down and 4. George with that sidearm toss and incomplete. Oliver came up on the coverage. There's a penalty marker down as the intended receiver was Doug Amaya, the tight end. And look at Lewis Oliver.
Where the penalty is, you can watch for Holden.
Oliver, 6'2 and 225 from Belgrade, Florida.
He's a tremendous athlete, but now watch. He's watching George's eyes. He's free. He's what they call a robber.
Still second down.
Which means a robber in football terms means he can sneak around and steal the ball anytime he wants to. He doesn't have an assignment.
And was a walk-on, a true walk-on at the University of Florida.
He's done one thing, though. He's been an All-American for 2 years in a row. That's the first time a Florida defensive player has ever done that. That's quite an honor.
Penalty was against Illinois. Second down and 14 now, so a 10-yard penalty against the Fighting Illini. 3:43 to go first half. George trying to screen it out or swing it out to the side. The intended receiver was Stephen Williams, and once again, a lot of pressure applied to Jeff George. Jeff Roth was one of the men in their 96, but what are they trying to do? They tried to do that play a couple times, and the Florida pressure has been too much for him.
They've called the screen at the wrong time because it's man-for-man coverage when you blitz. That's why George just throws the ball away. It was a screen pass, but Florida ran the blitz, and the linebackers had the screen man-for-man. That's why the play wasn't very good.
Third down and 14. Jeff George, who's playing for his third coach in 3 years, started at Purdue. Leon Burnett was there. Then, of course, came to Illinois, Mike White, now John McAfee. So it's been an experience for him. Lots of pressure that time. George can't elude it. Huey Richardson was the first man that got to him. And then Jeff Roth came in to finish him off.
Defensively as well offensively. When you're doing something that's doing well, keep doing it. They're blitzing again. Here they come. See the linebackers? 45 more is coming. All of them are coming. He tries to throw a little quick pass again, but man for man's coverage stops him, and Roth, number 96, makes the tackle.
And Menkhausen will come in to punt it from his 22-yard line, and Terrence Barber standing at the 30 for Florida on fourth down and 27. And he barely got that one off. Penalty marker goes down. A penalty marker is down. And Menkhausen was roughed.
If he was roughed, it's an automatic first down and a 15-yard penalty. If he was run into, it's only 5 yards. Now we'll see what he calls. But if he's run into, it's only a 5-yard penalty. But if he's roughed, which means he is intentionally hit, it's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
It looked like Jerry Odom, 57, was the man that made the contact.
We have personal foul, roughing the kicker against the defense. That's an automatic first down.
Boy, what a tough one. Automatic first down.
The reason why they're trying to block this, as I mentioned before, he's had 4 punts blocked. I think that's a good call. He ran into his head, which is a penalty. think it was a good call on the floor to defensive people to try to make something happen.
You're saying that the official made the right call? That was roughing?
Yes, and I'll tell you
why. That wasn't running into the kicker.
Well, the reason why it was roughing is because when he hit him with his leg way up, he's in the most dangerous position in football, and they protect the kicker.
First and 10. 48-yard line of Florida. 2:50 left to go, first half. Illinois decides to run it, and Jones will spin and work his way to the 46-yard line. Joey Nicoletto, Pat Moore to make the tackle. And all of a sudden, the Florida defense has become much more aggressive, and they're starting to set the tone of this game.
You know why? Because they've turned them loose, and they're starting to blitz. But be careful. When you do this, when you live by the sword, you die by the sword.
You put a lot of pressure on your secondary, don't you?
Absolutely. So then also, if a back breaks him, he goes all the way for a touchdown.
Second and 8. Both teams with 3 timeouts remaining in this first half. Penalty markers down as Jones cracks it inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. McGowan leading the way once again. Tonight's student of the game is brought to you by the U.S. Army. Learn how to get an edge on life. Be all you can be. And tonight's student of the game, a major in criminology and law, a 3.21 GPA. He has already graduated. He has his undergraduate degree from the University of Florida.
On the offense,
and that's Lewis Oliver.
Second down.
Lewis Oliver also won a national leadership award from a foreign automobile company that doesn't do too much advertising on ESPN. I would have mentioned their name.
Penalty against the University of Illinois.
Illegal procedure. The fullback moved before the snap, and that's a 5-yard penalty.
Second down and 13 now with 1:48 left. And Illinois with all 3 timeouts remaining. Plenty of time for Jeff George and plenty of time to find Frank Hartley is tied in. And Hartley is very close to a first down at the 38-yard line. Hartley is 6'3", 254-pound sophomore from Chicago. 13 yards on the pickup in just his second pass reception this year.
They did a nice thing that time. They sent both of their speed burners, one Williams and two Bellamy, deep, and that cleared out the whole zone, and that's why number 82, Hartley, was wide open. The backs were taken deep by the speedsters.
Watkins and Moore made the tackle, and do you think with just one pass reception coming into this game at 6'3", 254, they consider him a blocker more than a receiver? Enough for the first down, so Illinois has a first and 10 at the 38-yard line with 1:32 remaining.
And interesting, you notice how John Makovic has kept all of his timeouts. He has 3 left. That's his pro experience. They do a tremendous job in pro football of playing those timeouts.
Williams and Bellamy are split to the near side. 3 wide receivers for Illinois. And they come near side, and a nice catch by Mike Bellamy. He picked it right off his shoe tops, and he's driven out of bounds at the 35 by Richard Fain. So a gain of 3, and once again, the clock will stop with 1:26.
That used to drive me crazy, that play, as a head coach and my offensive coordinator would call it. You had to block everybody perfect. The quarterback had to throw the ball 37 yards down the field. The guy makes a great catch, and it's second down and 7. Let's get something. If you're going to take
too
a
much
tip,
work, right, for that
too much
yardage.
Work for 3 yards.
And too much risk.
You're not kidding.
Second and 7. Halfback pass. Broken up at the goal line. Beautiful defensive play by Richard Fain and Lewis Oliver as Keith Jones, who's already thrown a couple of touchdown passes this year, nearly had another.
Just like we thought, but I tell you what, Florida did a good job of scouting him. There's number 18, Oliver. He was ready for that kind of a play, so was number 28, Fain. Scouting them means that they know in this area, the 35-yard line, which they call the red zone, this is where they like to throw the running pass. Excellent play by the secondary of the Florida Gators.
Sean Wax was the intended receiver. He'll split to the far side right now along with Stephen Williams. Bellamy to the near side on 3rd and 7. Here comes Florida, and great pressure that time by the Florida Gators. They were bringing the backers one more time, and the pass goes incomplete. So Florida really starting to blitz here in the latter stages of the first half, as Tim Paulk was the man coming hard once again, and Menkhausen, the punter, will come in on a 4th and 7 at the 35-yard line.
Florida will not rush the kicker this time, I'll bet you.
1:14 left to go, and remember, Florida has all three of their timeouts. Menkhausen, a nice tight spiral. A beautiful job by Brian Menkhausen as the ball is down at the 3-yard line, 32 yards on the punt at halftime here at the All-American Bowl. The Russell Athletic Corporation, their involvement in this event, the Children's Hospital of Alabama, the Alabama reunion, and halftime statistics and highlights. Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, and myself will be here with you at halftime at the 12th annual All-American Bowl. And I'll tell you, the Russell Athletic Corporation really supports this event with scholarship monies. Chris will have more on that. And, of course, the hospital involvement here. 1st and 10 at the 4-yard line. Emmett Smith in not much room as he gets across the 5 to the 7.
The way the game has been going right now, it would probably be a smart move by Galen Hall to let the clock run out. Going into halftime 7-7, because I tell you what, Illinois has taken the momentum away from Florida. Florida must blitz to keep in the game.
But Illinois is going to take a timeout with 47 seconds remaining. It must. 2nd and 7. 47 seconds left to go, first half. Full house backfield by the Florida Gators, and Emmett Smith has got it. And he's got some room as he turns it across the 10 up to the 12-yard line. He's going to be just shy of the first down.
Illinois will call a timeout again.
Illinois is really putting the pressure on Florida right now, making their coaching staff make a couple of decisions, because, as you mentioned earlier, Florida's had some problems with their punting game. And all of a sudden, you know what could happen? You could have a punt blocked, and all of a sudden, Illinois is right there on the doorstep to score. 1980s have been good for Florida. They've been to 6 bowl games now. Last year, they lost to UCLA in a close game. 83 Gator, they defeated Iowa. Lost to Arkansas in the 82 Bluebonnet. Lost to West Virginia in the 81 Peach, and then defeated Maryland in the 80 Tangerine Bowl.
But remember, the games they won were in Florida. The games they lost were out of state. They have never won a bowl game that wasn't played in the state of Florida.
But this is just about as close as you can get to the state of Florida, with the exception of maybe the Peach Bowl, you know, of being.
Yeah, but if it was Florida, he wouldn't be wearing that sweater.
At Legion Field, that's how they've done. And, of course, the big victory in 87 against Alabama when Emmett Smith had that big game. Well, you know, it gets cold in Florida, Lee, this time of the year. Now, you can't tell me that they don't shiver a little in Gainesville and Tallahassee. Huh?
Not during bowl time, they don't. You know, Galen Hall has been in 18 bowl games as a player and a coach in his career. That's amazing. 18. He should know what to do here.
Played at Penn State, coached at Oklahoma. 3rd down and 3 now. 36 seconds to go. And they'll give it to McClendon. He's run out of bounds. That stops the clock, and it's going to be very close to the first down. But what it does is it saves a timeout for Illinois. If Florida did not get the first down, it depends where they marked it at.
Galen Hall is beside himself. He just said, thank you very, very much, because I'll tell you what, if by chance he would have saved that timeout and ran out of bounds and not made the first down, his heart would have stopped. Now they can't run the clock out and get out of here with a 7-7 tie.
So first down for Florida, 31 seconds remain. I don't know, why not throw one up?
No way. No way. They'll intercept it, run it back, kick a field goal, go down 10. Just go toss it out there. That's it.
McClendon again, and he's going to run out of bounds. Well, you don't want to do that either, do you, Lee?
No, sir. And that's why Galen Hall is shaking his head. Now, McClendon is a young freshman. We'll learn better, but what you try to do in this situation is forget it. Don't give it to McClendon anymore. Just take the quarterback and drop on one knee, then you don't have that problem.
Jalion Brown forced McClendon out of bounds on the far side. 26 seconds remain. Illinois still has one timeout remaining on 2nd and 9. Morris, the freshman from Clinton, Mississippi, taking a good look. And they're going to go to McClendon again up the middle. He stopped at the 20.
I tell you what drives me crazy. Why would you turn and give the ball to McClendon, a freshman, when he could fumble it when you're trying to run the clock out? Take the quarterback, drop to one knee, and then you have no problems with a fumble.
You never forget the old Joe Pisarcik handoff, do you, in that Giants-Eagles game? That's finally going to end the first half from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. And boy, what a great start we got off to. The opening offensive play, Emmett Smith, the 55-yard touchdown run. Illinois getting ready to pound it in. Pass intercepted by Florida in the end zone. Illinois came back with the interception. And then Keith, as Florida and John David Francis will kick it off as we start the second half. And Jones bottles it. The 3 up to the 20, still running to the 24-yard line, where for the Florida Gators it was 53 Brent Ellis. Plus yardage in gray, minus yardage in red, and the scoring drive in the yellow.
You'll notice what they have good in movement of the football most of the time. They didn't get stopped any times. But the secret to Illinois is the fact that they move the ball around a lot better than Florida. They move the ball up and down the field also.
First and 10 for the Fighting Illini at the 23-yard line as we're underway. Second half of the All-American Bowl. Both wide receivers split to the far side. They hand it straight up the middle. That's Howard Griffith, the fullback, who gets across the 25 to the 26. Jeff Roth, the left tackle, and Brad Culpepper, the middle guard, make the stop. Now, Roth started at middle guard all year, but when Trace Armstrong had the arthroscopic surgery, Roth moved out to Armstrong's spotted left tackle. Culpepper, the freshman from Tallahassee, who's playing for the University of Florida in Gainesville, moves into the starting spot at middle guard. 2nd and 7. Jones is a lone setback as Amaya comes in motion to the near side. And stuck behind the line of scrimmage at the 21-yard line, Huey Richardson came in to make the hit. 6'5 and 233, a sophomore from Atlanta.
He was considered the best defensive linebacker in the state of Florida. Watch him, in Georgia. Watch him make penetration. The reason why he got in that quick is he started on the outside and he had enough quickness to get to the inside on an inside move and beat the offensive lineman to a point of attack.
3rd down and 11 now for Illinois as George will work out of the shotgun. They try to screen it to the near side. Dangerous pass right there. Keith Jones, the intended receiver. They faked a little handoff to the inside, and that's the pass they've been trying to get to Jones, but Florida's done a great job defending it. Owen Bartrup was over there that time. And that'll bring up a punting situation. Menkhausen will be standing inside his 10. And Terrence Barber will be back at the 44-yard line. Bouncing around at the 40, and that's where it'll be down. And a punt of 38 yards. Florida will have good field position at their own 40 as we take a look at the Gators' possession.
Watch the first one. Touchdown. Now, as you watch the rest of them, you will see a nice drive, but they missed a field goal. And from then on, they did very little of consistent offensive play. An interception, a punt, and a halftime.
A lot of gray matter.
That's right.
Morris, the freshman from Clinton, Mississippi, is the quarterback. 1st and 10, call it the 41-yard line. Morris to Barber across the middle, and a gain of about 3. That is a pass that Morris has not completed tonight, and that is a pass Morris has had problems completing all year.
What they do is they take all the wideouts and send them deep, and they'll run an inside pattern with the outside man. That time he completed a pass for 6 inches.
They're going to bring it back, actually, and spot it right at the 41-yard line. Call it a gain of 6 inches, I guess, right? Barber caught the ball at about the 43, but ran backwards, as you see the stats on Kyle Morris. Emmett Smith on the near side. He's got a block, and Emmett Smith's got some room across midfield to the 46-yard line, where he was met head-on by Chris Green.
Nice call from upstairs. This time they fake the ball to him, and then they'll throw a little bit of a tailback screen. Watch him slip out there. He gets a good block by number 72, John Durden, right there. And number 52 probably gets a good block, and he lowers his shoulder and smashes into the guy. He's a very, very elusive ball carrier, but I like the idea of Florida getting the ball to him by throwing it to him also.
Emmett Smith. Florida, first and 10 as Smith has it. Across the 45, down to the 43-yard line is Emmett Smith. And a gain of about 5 as Steve Glasson, an inside backer, made the tackle. You know, Emmett Smith just caught 10 passes this year. As Florida just had an awfully hard time throwing the football after Stacy Simmons suffered the knee injury.
Emmett Smith's such a great player. He's the first Florida player ever to make All-SEC his first 2 years at Florida.
Second and 5 from the 42. Morris. Intercepted. Intercepted on the far side. Henry Jones. With his third interception of the year.
Kyle Morris will fake the ball to the right, but now watch his eyes. He immediately turns his head to where he's going to throw the ball. You see him? He's what they call bird dogging, which means he's looking at the receiver too long, and that gave Jones, who's from St. Louis, Missouri, a chance to move on the football and intercept him.
This presentation of the 1988 All-American Bowl, Illinois versus Florida, is being brought to you by Isuzu, the first car builders of Japan, and by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start. Roger Twada, Lee Corso, Chris Fowler with you. Legion Field, Birmingham, Alabama, tied at 7, the third pass interception of this game. And Illinois has it first and 10 from the 26-yard line. George going down the middle is tight end Doug Amaya at the 40-yard line, and that's a first down for the Fighting Illini. Huey Richardson, Lewis Oliver make the tackle, 14 yards on the pickup.
That time, number 45, Pat Moore blitzed, and number 29, Griffin, picked him up, and they threw the ball exactly in the spot that number 45, Moore, should have been if he'd have dropped. Excellent read by George, the quarterback.
First and 10 at the 40. Sean Wax is split to the near side, and Hartley comes in motion. Inside handoff to Keith Jones, and Jones is up to the 45-yard line. Owen Bartriff, one of the men in on the stop. Also there, Joey Nicoletto for the Gators. Now, as we've seen, Lee, throughout this year, and we've had a couple of Florida games against Auburn and Florida State, their defense is one of the best in the country, but the offense puts them in a hole so many times and puts their backs against the wall, and it's starting to show here in the early going of the third quarter. Pursuit that time by the Florida defense as Jones is dropped at the 42 and a fumble. A fumble, and Kerry Watkins comes up with it. Keith Jones fumbled the football. Good penetration that time by the Florida defense, and the turnover goes to Florida.
Number 90, Huey Richardson, comes from the outside. You'll watch a streak right to the right-hand side of your picture. You see that? That was Richardson. He's the gentleman that caused the problem, and then their number 45, Moore, knocks the ball loose, and it's a recovery for Florida.
Looked like it might have have been Nicoletta who got to it first. Nonetheless, it's good field position at the 43 of Illinois for the Florida Gators. They'll reverse it. Barber is going to throw it. Terrence Barber going to Lomac, and he drops it. It was the end around to Barber who threw it downfield to Lomac, and I'm here to tell you that Lomac had somebody tugging on him for about 7 yards.
Perfect call. Give the ball to your number one man as the bait. Hands it off to Barber number three, who lets it go. Now Lomac has to make an adjustment. Now watch. He has to turn his head and shoulders and can't quite bring it in. But I tell you what, that was a perfect pass from Barber to Lomac.
And look at Barber, the wide receiver. Does he? Oh, he'd rather throw a touchdown pass than catch one. 33, Chris Green was the man on the coverage, second and 10. Nearly intercepted that time. It was Marlon Primus, the freshman from Carson, California, who had nothing but Legion Field turf in front of him.
Keep your eye on that gentleman right there. I'll predict that within 2 years, that will be the Jim Thorpe Award winner as the most outstanding defensive back in the country. He's 6'2", 202. He's a freshman. He's an outstanding football player. He's second team All Big Ten as a freshman.
Made 93 tackles and had 3 interceptions. Marlon Primus.
Jim Thorpe nominee immediately.
Third down and 10. Morris coming near side. He's thrown into coverage now. That was nearly picked off. Green was over there. Also Glenn Cobb. And so after the turnover, Florida can't do anything with it, and they're going to be forced into a punting situation. But, you know, it's interestingly how closely together the 4 turnovers have come.
One of the good things that I liked about Florida, though, at least they tried to do something. I mean, late they went through a little reverse and threw the ball, they throw the ball, but now they're going to get good field position if you'll just punt the ball inside the 10.
Francis from the 42-yard line will punt it for the Gators. And he turns it over, the fair catch called. The fair catch made by Stephen Williams, and Illinois will take it from the 12 when we come back. In the third quarter, Lee, is this the case of the offenses decelerating and the defenses accelerating, or what?
What's happened is the Florida team has changed their philosophy from a contained group to an attacking group, and it's got Illinois off balance. Illinois has turned the ball over on a really very questionable call on that fumble. It looked like the ball was already whistled dead. But Illinois has the momentum because they've got better balance in their attack.
And Jones will take it. And he is stuck at the 13, a gain of about 1. Let's go to Chris Fowler. Chris?
Okay, fellas. This has been a tragic day for one of the Florida coaches. Early this morning in Orlando, Florida, Debbie Dickey was killed in a car accident. Debbie was the daughter of Jim Dickey, the Gators' secondary coach, former head coach at Kansas. Dickey and his wife, Ernest, have left Birmingham to go back to Orlando, and certainly the condolences of everyone at ESPN to him and his family. Fellas?
Okay, thank you very much, Chris. It really puts everything in proper perspective, and especially this time of the year. Once again, our condolences to the Dickey family. Jim, former head coach at Kansas State University. On the second down, the pass completed to the far side to Stephen Williams at the 17-yard line. Richard Fain over in the coverage. Lee, to get back to that, what does that do now to the coaching situation for the University of Florida without Dickey, the secondary coach, not being here tonight?
One of the things it has done is brought Bill Arnsbacher, the athletic director, into the box, sitting right next to us. Not that he's doing anything else, but Galen Hall, as the head coach, could make no changes because it just happened recently in a tragic situation. So Galen didn't do anything. He let David Arnsbacher, who is a graduate assistant under Jim Dickey, just take over the secondary for this game so far.
Third down and 5 from the 17 for Illinois. Jeff George out of the shotgun, intended for Sean Wax. And good coverage by Jerry Odom, the sophomore from Merritt Island, who put a good stick on. And that'll bring up a punting situation, and Brian Menkhausen. And we talked at the top that and even both coaches admitted to us that their punting games had been really less than adequate this year. We've seen nearly one disaster in the punting game with a high snap for Florida. Francis got out of that, but you wonder if there's going to be a major breakdown in that part of the game before the night's over. As from inside the 5, a low line drive kick, Barber gets it to the 42, so the Gators will have excellent field position again.
Remember we saw Randy Rogers, the recruiting coach, coordinator, call people on the phone? I'll guarantee you, he was talking to punters. And punters were really excited about looking to come to the University of Illinois.
SeaWorld Holiday Bowl tomorrow night from San Diego, Wyoming, against Oklahoma State and Heisman Trophy winner Barry Sanders. That at 8 Eastern time, folks. You won't want to miss that one. Both Wyoming and Oklahoma State, exciting football teams. And then, of course, Sunday, the Mazda Gator Bowl, Georgia and Michigan State. Vince Dooley's final game as head football coach for them Dogs, as Emmett Smith takes it to the 39-yard line, a gain of 3 with a sophomore from Pensacola. Smith, who's 5'10", 205, tackled by Derek Brownlow. And checking into the game is Herbert Perry now, quarterback. And Perry's a 6'2", 204-pounder from Mayo, Florida, and has really split time this year with Kyle Morris.
Perry is an outstanding baseball player. He'll miss next spring football because of his baseball love, and that could hurt him in becoming the number one quarterback at Florida.
Second down and 6 as they go to Emmett Smith one more time. And Smith down inside the 35 to the 34. Glenn Cobb, the strong safety from Pasadena, California, comes up to make the stop. You know, there are a number of California players and junior college players in the Illinois roster. Mike White, who, of course, was from California, the head coach, recruited a lot of J.C. players. John Makovic is not going to go that route at Illinois, is he?
The reason he isn't is he doesn't have the contacts out in California. And there's no reason going all the way across the country if you got to talk a player into coming that you don't have anybody to leave behind as a friend.
14 carries, 97 yards for Emmett Smith. 3rd and 2, he gets it again, and he's going to be very close to the first down at the 32-yard line. Glenn Cobb came busting up from his strong side safety position to get in on the tackle. And it's going to be a first down for the Gators.
It looked like the Gators said on the sideline, the offensive line, hey, coach, let's quit messing around with all of this passing stuff. Let's roll up our sleeves, and let's find out who's a better man, us or them.
They've also got Willie McGrady in there now, number 38. He's 6'1", 244 pounds, a tremendous blocker who's now lined up at the fullback position for the Gators.
He's a former All-State defensive tackle in high school.
And they go to Emmett Smith. McGrady's in front of him, and look at Smith inside the 25 to the 24-yard line, right behind Willie McGrady as Derek Brownlow makes the tackle.
Also behind David Williams, 6'5", 290, a four-year starter, number 73, the left tackle. You'll see the offensive line starts to surge now. Watch the left side, number 61, Sills from Orlando, number 73 makes a block, but number 38, McGrady is the man that makes that play go.
He kicked John Walker out of there. 2nd down and 3. Now they go to McGrady that time, and he gets to the line of scrimmage. Mo Gardner met him head on. That play didn't fool Illinois at all. It was 6:15 to go, third quarter. So now Florida is faced with a 3rd and a long 3.
If I was the Florida coaching staff, instead of throwing the ball here, which I know everybody would think, I'd somehow get the ball into the hands of number 22, let him break a tackle, make a first down, and keep the ball.
You come to the wide side,
doesn't make any difference. It depends on what the Illinois defense. I've caught it automatic, but I'd make sure that number 22 got the football.
3rd and 3. And 22's got the football. He'd like to throw it. Now he's going to run it. And he doesn't get to the first down. He needed to get to the 21-yard line, and he's out of bounds at the 22. Now, Lee, was that designed? He kind of put the ball in his hip. It looked like he was going to cock it to throw it, and then he tucked it under and went.
It might have been a running pass to Reed, but it looked like to me what they were trying to do is get the ball to the outside to Smith. Good call. And if he didn't make it, at least they could kick a field goal from the right hash mark. The right hash mark. Yeah, he might have looked like he wanted to throw it. But he's not a passer, he's a runner. Now, the reason they run it to the right, Roger, is right-handed soccer kickers kick better from the right hash mark because they can swing their foot and get it through right to left on a hook.
Let's call it a 39-yard attempt. He's 5 of 6 from that distance this year. That's John David Francis, and it's no good. It's no good. So Francis, on 4th and just really inches, they decide to go for the field goal, and Francis misses his 2nd field goal attempt of the night.
Okay, good call. The reason he missed this one was the high snap. You notice the high snap? The high snap got his timing off, and he didn't get to duck hook
in good position. Look at, he's trying to get the lean. No. Illinois tied up at 7 with 5:33 to go third quarter. Along with Chris Fowler and Lee Corso, I'm Roger Twyball. Glad you can be with us tonight here in Birmingham for the 12th All-American Bowl. As Illinois has a 1st and 10 from the 22-yard line after the missed field goal by Francis. The Illini looking to screen it to the left, and George is dunked at the 6-yard line by Huey Richardson. Boy, he is a tremendous sophomore from Atlanta, Georgia.
He's an outstanding student, too. He's got a 3.16 grade point average. He's an outstanding athlete because of his quickness. Now, watch the way he gets off the ball. He beats number 68, Snyder, to the inside, and that's all he needs is a little action. The reason why Richardson is doing such a great job, he's got great closing speed. He gets on him. You know, see how he gets on him so quick? But George has no way to throw the football.
And all their sacks, Lee, are coming from the outside. 2nd and 25 from the 7. George, lots of pressure. He finds his man. Jones has it and moves it to the 14-yard line. Goodness. What great, great anticipation by Jeff George. I mean, he had two men bearing right down on him. Looked to me like he was throwing it away.
They're really coming. They're teeing off. But watch the presence he has. He notices he's in trouble right now. He looks immediately to get the ball to his drop-off man, number 36, Jones. But also, did you notice those rib pads? Thank goodness he's wearing those rib pads because he's really taking some shots.
3rd down and 18 from the 14-yard line. 3 wide receivers out of the shotgun for the Fighting Illini. George throws it back across the grain as he's chased out of bounds at the 12. The pass is incomplete. Godfrey Miles was applying the pressure, and Jeff George is slow in getting up.
I think he hurt his ankle when they rushed him out of bounds. He might have hurt his left ankle or his left knee. Now watch him. He's being chased there by Miles. As he throws the football, I believe Miles gets him on the left knee.
No.
The right knee.
He got it. He got a hold of his left leg, and that his right knee buckled under. And the Illinois trainer has come over to check out Jeff George at the 5-yard line. George tried to get up and get back to the other side of the field, that is the Florida side of the field. He's wearing braces, Lee, on both knees.
I always believe that you should put your quarterback in those braces because they plant their feet and they get hit below the waist a lot. As he's rolling out of here, number 98, Miles, is trying to catch him. Now he throws the ball away, and we'll take a look at it.
Yeah, see his right knee buckled there. He had a hold of his left leg, and the right knee buckled. See, those protective braces, the offensive linemen wear them, and more than anything, I've been told by players that where they really come in handy is when you get hit by a helmet on that knee. I've seen those braces just bent up an inch or two, and they say, you know, that's when you really are protected by those braces. Let's go down to Chris Fowler. Chris?
Okay, Roger, let's throw it back up to you while Illinois tries to get this punt off. We'll come right back down and talk to Trace Armstrong, the defensive tackle All-America for the Gators.
Okay, Trace Armstrong, of course, who had arthroscopic knee surgery and is not playing tonight as Illinois will punt it, Meckhausen from his goal line.
Getting back to that, it's a good thing George had those braces on or he might be getting surgery tomorrow.
Good snap and a good kick. A low kick, but it drives Barber back to the 45, and excellent coverage by Illinois. And Florida, though, will have good field position at the 50. Let's go back down to Chris.
Okay, Roger. Grace, a lot of Gator fans concerned without you in there. The defense might have some problems. You're impressed with how they're playing, though.
Yeah, I think they played well in the second quarter and exceptionally well this half.
What happened at half?
halftime. You said that you'd noticed some effects from not having played a game in a month.
Yeah, it was just a matter of the coaches calming everybody down and establishing a tempo and reminding some guys of assignments.
Feel comfortable you guys can shut down this passing game in the second half?
Yeah, I think so. I think we really settled down, and the young players who are a little rusty are, back in the rhythm.
Okay, good luck in the draft in the NFL. Roger?
Okay, Chris, first and 10. They swing it out to McClendon. McClendon's got room to the outside, but a beautiful defensive play made by Henry Jones at the 45-yard line, which turns a big gain into just a 6-yard gain.
Nice little call that time. Get him to throw the ball out to McClendon, number 5, on a little screen pass. Speaking of screen passes, Bob Zupke, the coach of Illinois, invented the screen pass. Long time ago. And he also invented spring practice and huddle.
See, I knew I didn't like that guy. I knew there was something I didn't like about that guy. Second and 4. And it's McClendon again. They're making use of him inside the 40, down to the 38-yard line, and that'll be enough for the first down. Now, they're taping the left ankle of Jeff George, so obviously the braces protected the knee, but the ankle was turned over.
Okay, from a right-handed passer's standpoint, the left ankle is not bad, because you got to throw off your right ankle. It's a better injury on the left ankle than it is the right ankle if you had to have one of the injuries.
Look at this formation by Florida. Here.
That's the shift, and to try to get Illinois defense outflanked, and then they toss the ball.
Penalty markers down on first and 10 from the 38-yard line. Did they outfox themselves?
Absolutely. What they did is they messed around and didn't get the ball off in 25 seconds, and it cost them 5 yards.
Dead ball, false start, offensive lineman, replay first down.
So the penalty against Florida, and it'll be first and 15, 2:35 to go, third quarter. As the Gators have had outstanding field position in this third quarter, they've missed a field goal, had a good chance on a fourth and inches, but Francis couldn't connect. And that time, Florida to the 40, a gain of about 3 yards. Not much there that time for Dexter McNabb, who's in there for Emmett Smith. Herbert Perry has replaced Kyle Morris at quarterback. Mel Agee made the tackle for the Fighting Illini.
Florida has a one-dimensional attack. In the last 35 quarters, they haven't thrown a touchdown pass, Roger, in the last 35 quarters.
Stacey Simmons caught 4 touchdown passes in the first 4 games. Then he was injured. They've had 3 touchdown passes from other receivers than Stacey Simmons. This is second and 12. And Perry's got some room if he wants to go. He better tuck it in as he's inside the 40 to the 38. First man to hit him was Romero Bryce, a sophomore from New Orleans. As Perry had some room to go, he just couldn't decide. And finally, after a gain of about 4, hit the turf. That'll bring up a 3rd down and 9.
In the pass on 3rd down and try to get the ball if they can to one of their wideouts coming across the middle. But they haven't thrown the ball across the middle because I think they're afraid of number 16, Primus.
Perry will roll to the far side. Now he brings it back near side to McClendon. McClendon can get it to the outside. He's got something. He's still on his feet. He drives to the 31. That's not going to be enough for the first down. They needed to get to the 28-yard line. Chris Green was the man that made the tackle, but that's going to give Francis another try. And in that particular series, we didn't see Emmett Smith in there offensively for Florida. Maybe we can check and find out if there's a problem.
He'll probably be just going to try to give him a rest. But I'll tell you one thing. If I was a Florida coach, I'd put number 5, McClendon, and number 22, Smith, in the same backfield. They are 2 great players in the backfield for Florida.
49-yard field goal attempt now for John David Francis. He's 6 of 7 from that distance. He slips and hits the turf. It's short, and Francis is now 0-for-3. Francis thought there might have been a roughing call, but there is no penalty flag down. And so on their second consecutive possession, Florida has missed a field goal attempt.
Now, the reason it's not a roughing, the man was going for the spot. You know, see where he was going for? He was not going for number 7, and try to hit Francis, and that's why the official didn't call it. If it had been a roughing, it would have been a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down. It would have really helped the Gators. Let's go to Chris Fowler. Chris?
Okay, Roger, you see Jeff George back in there. They retaped his ankle. He's limping a little bit, but they didn't even warm up a backup quarterback, so they're going with George.
7 seconds to go now. Third quarter, as Keith Jones takes it to the 35-yard line. Gain of about three. And that'll end the third quarter of play from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Florida and Illinois tied at 7. Vince Dooley's final game as a head coach of Georgia.
After 25 years of magnificent man, and I tell you what, I'm sure he's distressed on as much controversy there is trying to pick a man to follow him.
Well, he's still the athletic director, and will be, because Starkey's going to run for governor of Georgia in 1990. Start of the fourth quarter, 2nd and 7, and over to the far side, Jeff George finds his receiver, Mike Bellamy, at the 47-yard line, and that'll be a first down. Roger Twyla, Lee Corso, Chris Fowler here with you at the 12th annual All-American Bowl. Let's go down to Chris.
Okay, Roger, injury report on the Florida Gator here. He was kidnapped by the Illinois cheerleaders. They threw him to the ground. He sustained an injury. He is limping back safely to the Florida side, however, appears to be okay. It's been a tough year for the Gators all around.
It's that kind of year. Even the mascot gets hurt.
Unbelievable. 1st and 10 from the 47-yard line. In motion to the near side for Illinois as they give it to Howard Griffith. And Griffith will get maybe a yard, not much more than that. Joey Nicoletto, the senior from Tampa, number 49, 75 tackles, 3 sacks and a couple of interceptions for the 6'3", 226-pound, 50-year senior. Just think, this is the final football game for a lot of these guys. You know, and it's now 14 minutes, 28 seconds to go, and it's going to start dawning on them, you know, during this period of time. This might be the last game some of these guys ever play. You're going to see some spirited action here as we come down to the conclusion of this game. Tied at 7, 2nd and 8. Keith Jones. Good battle right there as he drives hard across midfield. Gets down to the 47-yard line where Jeff Roth and Huey Richardson make the tackle.
Keith Jones, number 36, was the most valuable player in 1986. Also at Illinois, is an outstanding player. And he's down now. If you watch the replay, he'll break some tackles. He gets away right here from one man, lowers the shoulder. Boy, I'd love to see it back like that. He ran over number 57, Odom, and he gets hit there by number 4, Watkins, from the blind side. It might be that number 96, Roth, had his ankle and twisted it. Now, keep your eye.
His right knee, Roth's knee, on the back of Jones's right ankle. And let's hope that that's not an Achilles, as he is still down. Jones, 18 carries, 92 yards, and 1 touchdown. Of course, ripped off that 30-yard touchdown run. But more injuries occur in football by people falling on people. It's not so much the vicious hit. It's running downfield. Somebody's already tackling. Somebody else falls on you. But Jones, you can see him limping on that right ankle, is up. And he is the majority of the Illinois offense, their leading receiver and rusher.
He's probably the most versatile back in the Big Ten. He's from Rock Hill, Missouri, and has had an outstanding career at Illinois.
And he'll come out of the game right now. And he'll be replaced by Lynn McClellan. As you take a look at the total yards for Illinois and Florida. So McClellan, a senior from Rialto, California, number 28, has checked into the game on 3rd and 3. The blitz by Florida and lots of pressure. Pat Moore, 45, was the man that came through and put Jeff George on his back. And that'll bring up a punting situation, and Brian Menkhausen, the junior from Hazelwood, Missouri, will come in. Terrence Barber standing back inside his 15-yard line.
You almost get a feeling, Roger, that the game is going to be decided by someone making a mistake, especially in the kicking game.
Oh! by Menkhausen is down at the 15-yard line. And that's where the Gators will have it. First and 10, 13:31 left to go from Birmingham. Is being brought to you by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start. And by Isuzu, the first car builders of Japan. Roger Tribal, Lee Corso, Chris Fowler with you. 48,218, the official estimated attendance here tonight at Legion Field in Birmingham. First and 10 for the Gators now, and Herbert Perry looked over and called a timeout. And gosh, coming off a dead ball situation, you sure hate to take a timeout, don't you, Lee?
I have no idea what he saw that made him call that timeout. Because obviously the play was set from the sideline. Everybody knew it. He came out. He's trying to explain to the coaches now what he saw to cause that timeout. Because, boy, timeouts are so valuable.
The AFC NFC Pro Bowl coming your way on ESPN January 29th. That's 1989 as we move into the next calendar year. We'll have that one for you as our NFL coverage continues here on ESPN. Right now, we've got 13:31 left to go in the 12th annual All-American Bowl. Illinois and Florida tied at 7 apiece. As Perry went over to talk to Ray Cookmore and try to figure out whatever the problem was. Maybe he saw something defensively that baffled him, or maybe he saw something with his own team. But I guess it's better to be safe than sorry. So Florida has used one of their three timeouts. First and 10. Perry throwing and finds a receiver on the far side, Terrence Barber. At the 27-yard line, Chris Green on the coverage, and that's a Florida first down.
Nice play action play. Now let's take a look at number 73, Williams. Good hand. Now notice his arms. That's why he's going to be a great pro prospect. He's got long arms, and the first thing he'll do when he gets to the All-Star game is they'll take and measure his wingspan. The longer the arms, the more money he gets. That's to keep the defensive man away.
By the inch, right?
Absolutely.
First down. Call it the 29 now. Emmitt Smith is back in there, and he is dropped at the line of scrimmage by Mo Gardner, the sophomore from Indianapolis. This is a young defensive unit for Illinois. Their three up front men are sophomores. Brownlow's a sophomore. Bryce is a sophomore.
And that guy is a sophomore. I'll tell you one thing. You cannot single block number 95, Mo Gardner. You've got to block him from the angle. You notice how quick he was? He got his hands on that man and looked around him. Boy, that's a tremendous move.
They have only one senior starter on defense. Second and 9. As Willie Snead goes in motion to the far side. Perry going deep. Barber, the intended receiver, but he throws it out of bounds. And one of the backup guys caught it and started to run with it. Was that Moore?
Moore. Pat Moore now, number 45 from Pensacola, is the leading receiver for the Florida Gators.
The leading defensive receiver.
I mean, the only problem is he was sitting on the sideline. Can you imagine sitting on the sideline having a drink? The guy says, heads up, catch the ball.
Okay, Emmitt Smith is back in the game after missing that last series. Obviously giving him some rest. 3rd and 9 now. And the officials have now started the clock. 3rd and 9 for the Gators at the 30-yard line.
The Gators got to be careful. Do not turn the ball off with a blitz like this.
And they were coming, and they got him. At the 15-yard line, Perry is dropped by Derek Brownlow. That's his first sack of the year.
Now, they'll say, okay, you blitz at our quarterback. We'll come after yours. Brownlow, All-State High School in Indiana from Indianapolis, has got great speed. Now watch, as we watch Galen Hall, you'll see this, and oh no. But I'll tell you what, there was no choice. They had too many men and didn't have the hot pattern. That's why Perry got caught.
Francis standing on his goal line to punt it. He's had one high snap. That was a good one. It's an end-over-end kick. And Florida has got it down it at the 46-yard line. Greg Baldwin was down there to stop it. Just 31 yards in the punt. And now Illinois will have good field position.
You can't lose when you do that.
That's going to be a great one. Oklahoma State and Wyoming. And
speaking of great ones.
Yeah, you're talking about great ones right there for Illinois, and that's Mo Gardner, the nose tackle.
You know, with Mo Gardner and Marlon Primus, they might have the two best young people on
and AG.
And AG in the country. They might have the three top young people in the country.
From the 45-yard line, first and 10 for Illinois with 12:34 to go. They get it to the near side, and that's McClellan. And he is down inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. Huey Richardson makes the tackle. McClellan, the man who came in to replace Keith Jones. And this is putting the heat on Jeff George. He's been sacked three times. He's had eight hurries, one interception, and six knockdowns.
But they're doing a good thing now. They're using the Bob Zupke screen play. And the reason why they're doing the screen is they're letting the defensive people come in again, and they're just dumping the ball off.
That guy really invented spring football.
Absolutely.
Huh?
He invented the huddle. He was from Oak Park, Illinois. He was a high school coach from Oak Park and went to Illinois and became a legend.
Second down and three. George tries to flip it out to his tight end, Frank Hartley, and nothing there. Let's go to Chris Fowler.
Okay, Roger, an injury update on the Florida Gator here. You can see he's got some stitches in the back of his head, but he's worried that his parents think he's seriously hurt. Not to worry, the Gator's parents back there in the swamp, he's okay, he's back in the action, and he's vowing to get revenge against those Illinois cheerleaders that kidnapped him.
Okay, I guess Albert the Alligator won't be doing the Gator later tonight, huh? Third down and three at the 38-yard line from the I formation. McClellan leans ahead and good second effort, gets the first down at the 35-yard line. Pat Moore heading, but McClellan, the senior from Rialto, California, just wanted it a little bit more.
They run a counter-action play, which means they'll start to the right, give it back to the left. Now watch him. Two things. One, he delivers the throw by holding the ball on the right shoulder and driving just enough for the first down. The thing that I liked about that is he had the ball in his left arm, went into the left, he could use his right shoulder to put that pressure and make the first down.
McClellan only had seven carries coming into this game. He's already had three in this game, so a backup to Jones didn't see much action, but a big first down play there. First and 10, George being chased out of the pocket from behind and nailed by Huey Richardson at the 45-yard line. His cousin Al played for the Atlanta Falcons. And this guy's going to play in the NFL before it's all over with.
But now we'll get a good picture of number 64, Mark McGowan. Now watch him. They use what he calls a swim technique, which means he'll hit him at the jaw, and then he'll use his right shoulder and swim over his head, actually like a swimmer. That was a tremendous picture of the swim technique pass rush by number 90, Huey Richardson.
Loss of 10, second down and 20 now with 10:38 to go. See the quarterback sacks. Jeff George. Down the middle, he's got his receiver Steven Williams, and let's see if they call it a reception. Yes, they do at the 30-yard line. Pick up a 15 on the play.
Steven Williams had two brothers, Oliver and David, both great players at Illinois. But watch him come down and scoop the ball off the turf. It's a good thing we're not in the NFL. We'd be here for an hour and a half trying to figure that one out.
Third down and five now at the 30-yard line. Out of the shotgun, three wide receivers for Illinois. George finds Williams again. Good defensive play and not enough for the first down as Joey Nicoletto knew exactly where his man was at and exactly where he had to keep him. And that'll bring up a fourth down situation for Illinois.
Now we're taking a look at Mark McGowan again, number 64 from Evergreen Park. Now we got Richardson now, but you notice he's got his hands out there and he grabs it by the shirt. And now he keeps him out there and he grabs it by the shirt again. But he didn't get in.
Florida did a great job this year. They had 20 more sacks than their opponents throughout the regular season. Now Doug Higgins will come in. This field goal attempt of 44 yards. He was 4 of 6 from that area this year. plenty of distance, and it's good. So Wiggins, the sophomore from Normal, Illinois, with the 44-yard field goal, and the Fighting Illini have taken the lead for the first time tonight, 10-7, with 8:55 left to go in this football game.
Higgins is 6'1", 184, really gets his body into it. You notice how when he came through, he really put his body in there and got every inch and power of him behind it.
Illinois on top, 10-7. We'll kick it off now. 8:55 left to go in this game. High kick down the near side. And at the 11-yard line, it's Tony Lomack. Lomack with some room. Lomack to the 49-yard line, where he is brought down by Glenn Cobb, the last man he had to beat. 38 yards on the return, and the Gators have got great field position at midfield.
Fullback number 20 is from Tallahassee, Florida. He played at Leon High School for Gene Cox, one of the great coaches in the history of Florida High School. He makes a good move there. He was a tremendous running back in Tallahassee, Leon. He got over 5,000 yards in his career as a runner. They've got to try to get him into this game. We haven't called his name up until this point.
Lomack, the split to the near side with Terrence Barber on first and 10, and they give it to Emmett Smith around the corner, and Smith still going, and he stepped out of bounds. Smith stepped out of bounds at the 45-yard line, a gain of 5. He has got great quickness. Tell me the difference between speed and quickness.
All right, I'll tell you, the difference is speed and quickness is the ability to cross those lines fast. Now watch, right there, two steps and he was gone. You move your body with speed if you can run without anybody there. But quickness is the ability to move from one spot to the other with people around you. That's the difference.
Second and 6, they call it a 4-yard pickup for Emmett Smith. They go to him again. Smith looking for room. He gets to the 42. Derek Brownlow, 48. The inside backer comes up to make the stop, and you can see the exchange there. Smith and Brownlow, both sophomores, acknowledging each other.
There's Brownlow. He's reading the inside. Now watch him come the inside and out. But the reason that Brownlow is such an aggressive player is that he attacks the ball carrier. Boy, he's a tremendous football player. Derek Brownlow from Indianapolis, Indiana.
Third down and 2.
Give the ball to Smith again. If you don't make it, give it to him again.
Kyle Morris is back in at quarterback as they give it to Smith. Breaks one tackle. Smith trying to get to the outside. Smith down to the 30-yard line. Chris Green makes the tackle, and what a great individual effort by Emmett Smith.
What did I tell you? Just give him the ball. You don't even have to block. Just get most of the guys out of the way. Watch. He gets hit the backfield right there by number 65, Turner, but then it's all Emmett Smith, and he goes up the left-hand side. He gives a stiff arm right there to number 33, Green, which is the first time I've seen Emmett Smith do that.
You see, the great thing that Smith did there that all great backs do, as soon as he felt that contact, he spun, which didn't leave him as a sitting target. He kept moving that way, and Emmett Smith, 131 yards, and what have they won? 6 consecutive games when he's rushed for over 100 yards. Morris hands it straight up the middle to his first back through, and a gain of about 3 yards. Cedric Smith, a junior from Enterprise, Alabama, is tackled by Mel Agee. We really haven't called Agee's name that much. He's been injured throughout most of the end of the season as the Gator, speaking of injuries, patched up and back cheering again. But Gardner has done the job from the nose guard position, and Brownlow from the linebacker position on 2nd and 8. McClendon fumbles the football. Still loose.
You're resting Emmett Smith. He's tired. You give the ball to McClendon, who's only a freshman. He's got the ball tucked away, except he doesn't bring the ball into his body, and the ball is knocked out by a helmet. You've got to teach a young guy, when you hit the line, two hands on that football, especially with 6:48 to go. You do not criticize Galen Hall for having number five in there, though, because Emmitt Smith was really tired on that last run.
Trying to get a number on who recovered the ball. It kept bouncing around. Nonetheless, Illinois has it. First and 10 with 6:45 to go, and immediately tackled behind the line of scrimmage. And Rondi Weston came busting through to get McClellan for a loss of about five.
The Gators have got to, right now, got to stop them right here. They cannot let them keep the clock going. They're not only fighting a 10-7 deficit, they're fighting 6:25 and counting on the clock.
Mel Agee was the man that came up with the fumble recovery. Second down and 14. George trying to get away from the pressure, has it deflected straight up in the air, and the man who was back was Jeff Roth, who got a hand on it. Let's go to Chris Fowler.
Okay, Roger, injury report on the fabulous halfback for Illinois. You see him right there, Keith Jones. He's hurt his right ankle. Trainers have taken off his shoe and his sock, and they're looking at that right ankle. We've got a nice bag out there. Jones, the most valuable player on this Illinois team. His teammates come up to him and said, we're going to win this one for you, guy. Fellas.
Thank you, Chris. Keith Jones, 18 carries, 92 yards, and a touchdown. And they'll sorely miss him in the final 6 minutes of this game. Third down and 14 now.
Florida needs a big play on defense. As soon as they can get one.
Roth was coming hard. Intercepted. Intercepted. Owen Bartrip was the man that picked it off. Owen Bartrip, the linebacker, with his second interception of the year. 6'1 and 200, a former defensive back who's a linebacker, made the pick.
This is what they needed. Third down and long. They played a nice zone defense. George overthrows. Bartrip is back in position to get it. He's from Sarasota, Florida. He makes a good play. He holds onto the football. Now it's on the 25-yard line. Get Smith back in the ball game. Get him the football as many times as you can. He will either win it or lose it, and therefore you go with your best man.
5:50 left to go. 10-7. Illinois leads it. Smith in motion. Cedric Smith, Emmitt Smith has got the football, and he's inside the 25 to the 24-yard line. Mel Agee made the tackle, and that time on a third and long, Jeff George tried to force it in, and it didn't work.
That's right, and Florida did a nice thing. They faked the blitz that time and went to coverage defense. He thought he'd get more pressure in that, and then Bartlett was in good position. What Florida needs to do right now is get the ball in the hands of Smith four times, if necessary, but make that first down.
Second and 9. Morris is checking off the line of scrimmage, and Smith goes up to the slot on the left side. They were looking to throw to him. He gets Terrence Barber instead. And Barber inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. They're saying the clock should continue to run, that he didn't get out of bounds. And now they stopped it at 5:02. Derek Brownlow made the tackle. Jeff George, 152 yards passing. Jones, 92 yards rushing and a touchdown. Smith, 132 yards rushing and a TD. And Francis has missed 3 field goals. The first one was a high snap. The other two he missed on his own. Third down and 3. Double tight end. Emmitt Smith. Nowhere to go. Now he comes to the other side. He's got all sorts of room. Smith could go all the way. He's downed at the 3-yard line. Marlon Primus with a touchdown saving tackle, a 15-yard pickup by Emmitt Smith.
They didn't block anybody, but when you got a guy like Smith, you might be better off not blocking anybody and then running his own. He breaks it out to the outside. He gets a tremendous block there by number 80, McGriff. And there goes Smith. Now, Primus really smashes him in there on the 3-yard line. Now what you do, you get in the T formation, and whatever you do, you make sure that number 22 gets it or you fake it to him.
First and goal from the 2. Smith!
Florida.
Of course, sir, I don't know what you're doing up here. You ought to be down on the field for somebody.
Coaching for you has always been, if you're going to win or lose, you go with your stuff. If you're going to win this game, you're going to win it with number 22, and don't let anybody else mess it up for you. And that's exactly what Lynn Amity did in Galen Hall. They gave it to their star player, and he took them in there. Nice blocking on line of scrimmage, Roger. Nice blocking on the right side, and he just runs it in there.
He showtimed it in. That's what he did. 24 carries, 149 yards. Francis for the point after, the important point after, to give them a four-point lead, and he's got it. So now Illinois needs to score a touchdown as Florida leads at 14-10 with 4:28 to go.
Remember, Illinois beat Indiana by scoring two to come back and win it. Illinois went in a two-minute drill and tied Minnesota to get here. They have the ability to come back and score, no question.
They scored twice against Indiana with 2:06 to go. As we take a look at one more time, Smith, and he just dances in, folks.
What they did is the Illinois team did a pinch stunt, which means everybody went to the inside. Number 21, Dexter McNabb, picked up the outside guy, and number 22, Emma Smith from Pensacola, went in for the touchdown.
Did you see Smith when he had the ball high up in his hands and Jones tried to knock it out as he went in the end zone? Smith looked at him and said, "Hey, man, this is my time."
People in the country are finally getting to see an Emmitt Smith without the knee brace and without the bad knee.
He is a special kind of player, an outstanding freshman. Was the lead returning Heisman vote getter this year. Finished ninth in the balloting, and only the second time a freshman has finished ever in the top 10 of the Heisman Trophy balloting. So now the pressure is on Jeff George, and now, if John McAvick could do it, he'd give it to Keith Jones every time, but he doesn't have Keith Jones. So somebody else is going to have to step to the forefront. As Francis kicks it off, and they don't have Jones to return it. They do have Stephen Williams. And Williams is to the 25-yard line before he's run out of bounds. So Illinois has all three of their timeouts. 4 minutes and 22 seconds, and 75 yards to go.
And a quarterback who's done it before in the pressure away from home in Minnesota in a dome stadium that has the ability to come back. So George and his teammates can come back and win this ball game. Florida has got to fake some blitzes and hope that George overthrows and intercepts another one.
And it'll be interesting if Florida keeps up the aggressive defensive posture or if they'll sit back a little bit here. First and 10. George down the middle. He's got Stephen Williams at the 37-yard line. Williams tackled by Lewis Oliver. And with no qualms about it, he just steps back and finds his man over the middle. The scoring drive. Four plays, 26 yards. Time 1:22. The interception by Owen Bartriff to set it up. An interception set up the Illinois touchdown. Turnovers have been a big part of this game as the touchdowns have fallen. As up the middle, McClellan, good job of running across the 45 to the 46-yard line. Lewis Oliver makes the tackle. And so Lynn McClellan, the little-used senior from Rialto, California, has some big shoes to fill here in the final minutes of this All-American game.
If you were rooting for Illinois, you would not trade places with anybody in the country today and have John McAvick call the plays. He's done it in the big time a lot. He can do it again.
Second and two from the 46-yard line. McClellan again. And McClellan will have the first down as he gets up to the 48-yard line. McClellan had carried the ball seven times coming into this game, and he's already carried it that many times tonight. It's Emmitt Smith's preferred network. However, the Gators have never won on ESPN. They're 0-5.
But the Gators have done something pretty good. They won 4-0 against the Big Ten. The only team to beat them was Indiana beat them. 14-3 in 1960.
16?
16. That's the last time Florida
crossed. That was before you coached there, right?
A year or two.
Third and one. It wasn't quite enough for the first down as the mark was spotted at the 47. On the run, George throws a dangerous pass, but McClellan makes a tremendous catch, and he's got the first down at midfield.
28 Fain against 28. He ought to be. He hit him with his shoulder. It was a tremendous hit. They make a little fake action rollout, and they throw the ball to McClellan in the side. Watch him get hit right there. Ooh, it's a magnificent hit, but it's also a tremendous play by McClellan to hold on to that football.
They mark it just across midfield at the 49-yard line. First and 10, 2:19 left to go. George with plenty of time. And he's got his receiver, Bellamy. Bellamy inside the 45 to the 43-yard line. And there's a penalty marker down over in the area where Bellamy was brought down. And the possibility of a face mask, well, that's a distinct possibility. Ephesians Bartley was the man on the tackle. And that's the last thing Florida needs, is one of those kind of penalties with 2:06 left to go. Unintentional face mask. Now, Lee, has Florida changed their defensive posture here in this particular series?
Yes, they're not full blitzing them. And the reason why they're not full blitzing them, they don't want to get a long one on them. They want to see if George can take the ball the length of the field and stop them. I personally think that's the right strategy, because if they do catch him in a blitz and it's one-on-one, they've got number 8 out here. Jones, who hasn't played in the game, will have a right go right past him for a touchdown. If I was the Illinois coach, I'd come immediately to the right side here and tackle number 8 with number 1, Williams, against Jones.
Jones is a junior from Tallahassee, 1st and 10. Here comes the pressure. George is able to slip away, but he can't find anybody. And there really wasn't a receiver. Sean Wax was about 10 yards further downfield from where that ball was. George, 17 of 36 for 172 yards and 2 interceptions. He came into this game with 9 touchdown passes and 8 interceptions on the year.
Florida gets good pressure on George this time, but they only send 4 men, and that's the secret. If you can get 4 men in on the quarterback, you've got a great chance. That's 98 miles chasing him. And number 50, Culpepper.
2nd and 10. Coming to the near side, and the pass is complete at the 32-yard line. Another good catch over there. That was Howard Griffith. Joey Nicoletto was on the coverage, and we're under the 2-minute mark. Remember, 3 timeouts remaining for Illinois. It's 3rd and 4. George is hit, and the pass is complete to Bellamy inside the 20. To the 18-yard line where Kerry Watkins makes the stop. There's a penalty marker down. There's a penalty marker down, and holding's going to be called against Illinois. I'll tell you, George did a great job to get rid of the football.
Number 2, Mike Bellamy. You know why he's going to him? Because he's the guy that won the Indiana game for him, and he knows he'll come up with a big play right there. That was a perfect throw underneath. Sidearm, the pressure.
Holding on the offense. Still 3rd down.
So holding on Illinois, it will remain 3rd down, but the ball will move all the way back to the 47-yard line.
We're taking a look at the right side of your screen right there. It looks like number 68. Snyder had a hold of
Miles. Godfrey Miles again, who came busted in from the outside. So now Illinois has to get it all the way to the 27-yard line for a 1st down. The ball is marked at the 43-yard line. Third down and 16. Boy, he knew right where to go. It's going to be just short of the 1st down at the 29-yard line. Watkins made the hit. Bellamy made the reception. It'll be 4th now and just over a yard to go. And Illinois wants a timeout with 1:23 left to go. Odie with you at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. 4th down and 1 for Illinois at the 28-yard line of Florida. They've used their first timeout of the 2nd half. They have 2 remaining. They bring out Williams. And Bellamy to the near side. Off tackle to the right. McClellan is stuck behind the line of scrimmage by Huey Richardson.
He never had a chance. They went to the unbalanced line. The reason I said off tackle to the right, because that's exactly the same play they went for a touchdown. They went to the unbalanced line. Watch the man on the right-hand side of your picture. Inside stuck right there. Huey Richardson beat number 64 McMahon to the inside.
But McGowan went right by him like he wasn't supposed to block him, like he was going after a linebacker.
Probably that Richardson was so quick, gave him a shoulder fake one way and came to the inside. But it was a definite off tackle to the right like we thought they would do.
1:18 left to go. Illinois has two timeouts remaining. First and 10 for the Gators. And they give it to Emmitt Smith. Emmitt Smith across the 40 to the 42-yard line, a pickup of 7.
Roger, you knew it, I knew it, and everybody in the Illinois team knew they were going to give the ball to Emmitt Smith, and he made 7 yards by just sheer power and determination.
Jeff George, the sophomore quarterback for Illinois, began his collegiate career at Purdue, transferred to Illinois, led them to a 6-4-1 record this year, and he's got a great future. But the Gators of Florida, who started at 5-0 this year, and then had so much adversity, injuries, and uncertainty over Galen Hall's future at one point in time. They ended up losing 5 of their last 6 and only scored 7 touchdowns in the last 7 games, yet their defense was ranked 4th in the nation, and they got themselves in position with 107 left to go to put a smile on the face of a lot of Gator football fans and a lot of people involved with this program as they lead it 14-10 with 107 left to go.
What they'll do right now is they'll get the ball in Emmitt Smith's hands, and they'll usually throw the ball to the outside with Emmitt so that he can get a little bit of power and crease and go up the field.
The most valuable player trophy, the Fred Sinkton Sr. most valuable player trophy, has been awarded to Emmitt Smith of the University of Florida, and they are now with 107 left to go, and Illinois now with 1 timeout left, 2nd down and 4 for the Gators. Lomac comes in motion to the near side, and they give it to Emmitt Smith one more time, and he will be stopped behind the line of scrimmage at the 39-yard line, and Illinois will take their final timeout with 1 minute left to go, which means they could get the football back.
They'll try to block the punt. Basically, they'll let them run the next play. Florida will have to punt. They'll try to block the punt to win the ball game, and if Florida can get the ball off, then they'll win the ball game.
Glenn Cobb was the man that made that tackle. Timeout on the field, 1 minute left to go, and the Gators are celebrating already.
I know you don't like none of it. You know, I've always said that. No, sir. Nobody celebrates until the game's over. This game's not over yet. If they stop them here, which they probably will, Florida will have to do the thing they do the worst. Line up and punt the ball. Unless Galen Hall does something that I've done before. Take the ball, give it to Emmitt Smith, and let it run behind the end zone and take a safety.
You mean just run straight back?
Straight, as fast as he can run, right out there to the American goal sign, take 2 points, kick it off, and win the game.
That could be possible. Well, that makes it 14-12, and then you could always get a long field goal or something.
You'd have to have a mammoth field goal. But there wouldn't be any time left.
3rd down and 6. Barber's in motion to the far side. Pitch back to Emmitt Smith. He's got a handle on it, and he gets maybe a yard. So they'll have 4th down and 5. Was that a penalty marker that was thrown? There was a penalty marker thrown, and it looks like it's going to be a face mask call.
But it'll still be 4th down.
The turning point of the game.
We got a face mask, 5 yards, against the defense. Replay 3rd down.
Fourth quarter, 4:32 left to go. Emmitt Smith found nowhere to go on the left side. He turned it to the right side. And that was the turning point of the game as he got it down to the 3-yard line. That was a 5-yard penalty, a 5-yard face mask penalty. Now, does Does it remain third down?
It remains third down because it was the penalty occurred while the run was going. If it occurred after the man was down, it would have been fourth down.
So it's third down and one. The clock's running. Emmitt Smith gets the first down, and the Florida Gators will win their first bowl game outside the state of Florida ever.
And also beat a Big Ten team five times in a row.
And Emmitt Smith makes it seven in a row. And rushing over 100 yards, the Gators have won. 14-10. And I'll tell you what, it's been a long, long time since these guys have had much to cheer about. And the other thing we might add, the Gators win for the first time ever on ESPN. And in that regard, we're happy. 5 seconds left to go. The clock will run down, and the Florida Gators have defeated the Fighting Illini of Illinois 14-10. Emmitt Smith with two touchdown runs. The first offensive play of the game, 55 yards. And he finished things off with over 4 minutes to go in the game with another short touchdown run.
A great win for Florida. It was, the celebration is a little subdued now because of the tragedy that happened to Jim Dickey's daughter. But they'll be happy and excited. I know that Jim Dickey has had a tremendous tragedy in his life, and I know that they'll be happy that the Florida Gators won.
And Chris Fowler is down there with head coach Galen Hall of the Florida Gators. Chris?
Okay, Roger. Coach, some key defensive plays when you really needed them tonight. Our defense played well all night. They came up with a big play there. They made a couple key interceptions. They played great for the whole game.
You talked about the adversity of your senior class with the sanctions and they not being able to represent the conference. The Sugar Bowl, they really put it together tonight.
They really did. They all played well. A great group of seniors. Two Sugar Bowls taken away from us, and very proud of this senior class.
Emmitt Smith, what can you say about the guy? He's the MVP tonight.
Well, he's that type of player. He's a great, has great vision, great, very hard to knock off his feet. He's just one of the better backs in the nation.
Okay, thanks very much, Coach. Appreciate it. Roger.
Okay, thank you very much, Chris. Galen Hall, who sees his team win the All-American Bowl. They finished 7-5 on the season, and that's got a better ring to it, doesn't it? Final score, Florida 14 and Illinois 10. We'll return to
the last time I played here, it was a cloudy day. It was kind of cool, so I didn't get dehydrated. I believe that the weather tonight probably helped me out.
That's about your last touchdown run. You cut left, came back the other way.
Well, I forget what down it was. I was stopped at the line of scrimmage. I bounced off the defender, and I reversed field, and it was open, wide open.
In all honesty, it's been a tough year for this team. This has to be a good way to cap it.
I think this is the best way to cap it. We worked hard all year to get here, and I think we deserve a victory at a bowl game. It's our first victory in the bowl game for I don't know how long.
Okay, congratulations. Roger, Lee.
Okay, thank you very much, Chris. Yes, Emmitt Smith does perform nicely on ESPN. And here's a look at it. The first offensive play of the game and the good block by McGriff.
Good block by McGriff. He breaks one tackle right there, and he outruns number 33, Green, to the corner. He shows his great speed here along with his quickness. This set the tempo. Then he went to sleep. He couldn't do anything else. And then finally, Emmitt Smith came back into the fourth quarter, and he goes all the way and wins the game for him.
And there's the look of the Illinois bench and their feeling. And Galen Hall, who's had a very, very difficult year. And look at him. He just shakes his head and a little smile. And then, of course, the big play. The stick behind the line on the fourth and one. Huey Richardson, who had such a big night, came up with the big defensive play. And tomorrow, I want to remind you, from San Diego, the SeaWorld Holiday Bowl, Wyoming, against Oklahoma State and Heisman Trophy winner Barry Sanders at 8 Eastern time. And then Sunday, the Mazda Gator Bowl. Vince Dooley's final game as head coach of Georgia as the Bulldogs take on Michigan State, also at 8 Eastern time.